Countdown to Halloween 2022, featuring eerie and uncanny tales of haunts, ghosts, and suspense. The first Monday of every month, at exactly midnight, a new story will appear on StoryLink Radio's YouTube channel as we count down to Halloween 2022. Plan to catch these each month or you'll miss one. Each story will be 13 to 30 minutes long. And now, tonight's story from StoryLink Radio. Tonight's story is Darby O'Gill and the Banshees Halloween. In celebration of the month of the Irish, this is a 2-hour special presentation, originally recorded on St. Patrick's Day before two live audiences in the virtual world metaverse at the Shaughnessy Library in Second Life, at the StoryLink Radio Estate in OpenSim at Kitely. Please check the video description for any references to URLs or links that may be made during this presentation. Live presentations have their own special and unique peculiarities, but we feel this brings a more of an immediacy to the presentation, and so we have not edited out any of these. You may hear peculiar noises from your narrator or from those in the audience, or you may hear your narrator make references to people that were in the audience that night. And remember, if you ever want to join one of our live presentations, just visit our website, www.storylinkradio, to find out how to join us live. We hope you enjoy it. Before we get started, though, a quick backstory. Sometime previous to 1891, when Patrick Barton published an account of it, some legends of scary creatures of County Meath, a youth had the temerity to steal a comb from a banshee. Now, banshees are an Irish entity that's said to sing laments for people before they die, and for the crime of stealing the banshee's comb, the youth was haunted and driven by her phantom, keening and wailing until he was almost dead, at which time she gave the young lad the opportunity to return the comb to her. Now, interestingly, this account from early 1800s sometime was listed as an anomaly, and the author claimed this account was a true story. Now, the author, Patrick Barton himself, certainly believed in the existence of banshees, having stated, "The most authentic account I ever heard describes her as of dwarfish stature, golden hair, dressed in a red skirt, and devoid of feet." Well, the story of the youth in the comb was likely to have inspired Hermione Cavanaugh, the author of Darby O'Gill and the Good People. Now, this part's true, as, well, all of it is, I guess. I have a friend in County Meath, an older friend, who remembers being warned by her grandmother never to pick up a strange comb lying on the ground because a banshee might be waiting to spirit away the fool who touches it. And my own dear Irish nanny cautioned me as a wee lad not to pick up a comb from the ground. Now, I assumed it's because it was dirty with who knows whose cooties on it, right? And she told me yes, that, but also other reasons. At the time, unspecified reasons. And another aspect of the banshee legend says that the banshee would only wail for a member of one of the five ancient Irish families, the O'Neills, the O'Briens, the O'Connors, the O'Gradys, and the Cavanaughs. Well, that's it. On with the story. Chapter 1, The Diplomacy of Bridget. 'Twas the mending of clothes that All Souls afternoon in Elizabeth Ann Egan's kitchen that naturally brought up the subject of husbands and the best ways to manage them. And if there's one thing more than another that makes me take me hat off to the women, 'tis the audacious way the most downtrodden of their sex will brag about their blackguard husband. Not that either one or the other of the five busy-tongued and busy-fingered neighbor women who bent about their sewing or knitting that afternoon were downtrodden by no manner of means, far, far from that. They were so filled with matrimonial contentedness, that they fairly trampled down one another to be first in praising the wonderful men of their choice, their blackguard husband, that is. Each and every woman there proudly claimed to own and control the handsomest, likeliest man that ever trod in brogues. Then they talked so fast, they talked so loud, and was trying a long while before meek-voiced little Margaret Doyle could squeeze her husband, Dan'l John, sideways into the argument. And even when she did get him to the fore, the other women had appropriated all the heroic qualifications for their own husbands, so there was nothing left for Dan'l but the common Levinson. That deprivation settled Margaret and vexed her sore. but she took her chance when it came, poor as it was, and bolted in. Jabbing the air as though her needle were a dagger, Margaret broke into the discourse.
"Oi, I wouldn't trade my Dan for the King of Russia or the Emperor of China," says she,
peering defiant around the room. No one sided with that remark, and no one argued against it, and this vexed her all the more.
The Kingdom of China is where the most superior tea comes from," says Cecilia Crowe.
Now, Cecilia was a large and solemn woman, was Mistress Crowe, and a great historian.
No, I wouldn't," continued Margaret, scorning the interruption. "Not if the two men were rolled into one."
"Why," says Cecilia Crowe, and her deep voice tolled like a passing bell. "Why," says she, "should any decent woman be wanting to marry one of them heathen emperors like? Sure, they're all ambiguous," she says, looking around, proud of the grand word, ambiguous. Now Elizabeth Ann stopped the spinning wheel for better to listen, while the others turned and bothered faces to the historian.
"Ambiguous,"
says Mistress Crowe, raising her voice in the middle part of the word.
"Ambiguous," she says again, "means that according to the legal laws of some of them furrin parts, a man may marry 4 or 5 wives if he has a mind to."
Now at this, Margaret bristled up like a bantam hen.
"Do you mean to say to me, Cecilia Crowe," says she, dropping in her lap the waistcoat she was mending, "do you intend to substantiate that I'm wishing to marry the Emperor of China, or," she says, her voice growing high and cutting as an east wind, "do you wish to inferentiate that if my Dan'l had the lave, he'd be ambiguous? Will you please tell these friends and neighbors," she says, waving a hand, "which of the two of us you was minded to insinuate against?"
Now, the attack by Margaret was so sudden and so unexpected that Mistress Crowe was too bewildered to defend herself, and the poor woman only sat staring stupid at Margaret. Now, the others sunk back in their chairs, speechless with consternation, till Molly Scanlon, wishing to pacificate the situation and winking friendly at Cecilia, so spoke up soothing-like.
"Well, it's true for you, Margaret Doyle," says she. "What kind of talk is that for you to be talking to Cecilia? If Daniel John were to be made the Emperor of China tomorrow, he'd hesitate and deliberate a long time before bringing in one of them ambiguous women to you and the children, I know. I'd like to see him try it. And it'd be a sore and powerful day for him, I'm thinking."
Now, at them words, Margaret, in her mind's eye, saw Daniel John stand up for an instant with an ambiguous heathen woman on each side of him, and the picture riled the blood in her heart.
"Oh-ho!"
says Margaret, turning on poor shrinking Molly with a smile, and that smile had loaded guns and pistols in it.
"And will you please be so kind and condescending, Mistress Scanlon," says Margaret, "to explain what you ever saw or heard tell of in my Daniel John's actions, and it make you think he'd contemplate such a scoundrel endeavours as that,"
she says, beginning to tremble. Now the only answer to the question was from the tea kettle. It was singing high and impudent on the hob. Now, Bridget O'Gill, knowing woman that she was, had wisely kept out of this discourse. And Bridget sat apart, calmly knitting one of her dear Darby's winter stockings. As Bridget listened in, however, she couldn't keep back a sly smile that lifted one corner of her mouth.
"Isn't it a poor and pitiful case," says Mistress Doyle, glaring savage from one to the other, "that a decent man, the father of 9 children, 8 of them living and 1 gone for a soldier, isn't it a burning shame," she says, whimpering, "that such a decent man must have his character traduced before his own wife? Will you be so good as to tell me what you're laughing at, Bridget O'Gill, ma'am?"
Now Bridget, fluttering guiltily, tried to hide the misfortunate smile, but was too late.
"Because, Bridget, if it is my husband you're mocking at," says Margaret, "let me tell you fair and plain, his equals don't live in the county of Tipperary, let alone in this parish. 'Tis true," she says, tossing her head, "he hasn't spent 6 months with the good people. Aye, he knows nothing of the fairies, like your husband. But he has more sense than those that have, At any rate, he is not afeard of ghosts like a knowledgeable man that I could minion."
Now, that last thrust touched a sore spot in the heart of Bridget O'Gill. Although Darby O'Gill would fight a dozen living men if needful, 'twas well known that he had an unreasonable fear of ghosts. And so Bridget said never a word, but her brown eyes began to sparkle, and her red lips were drawn up to the size of a button. Margaret saw how hard she'd hit, and she went on triumphant.
My daddle John is sleep in the churchyard. He's done it, she says, a-crowing. Now Bridget O'Gill can hold in no longer. Well, I'd be sore and sorry, says she, if a husband of mine were drove to do such a thing as sleep in the churchyard, all for the sake of a little peace and quiet, she says, turning her shoulder. Now, Taylor announced, but that was the stroke. Oh, the Lord bless us, muttered Molly Scanlon. Margaret's mind went up in the air and stayed there whirling whilst she herself sat gasping and panting for a reply. 'Twas a thrilling, suspenseful minute, I'll tell you. The Chinese shepherd and the shepherdess on the mantel stopped goggling, and their eyes looked shocked at each other. At the same time, Bob, the linnet, in his wooden cage at the door, quit his singing and cocked his head the better to listen, and the surprised tea-kettle gave a gasp and a gurgle and spluttered over the fire. In the terrible silence, Elizabeth Egan got up to wet the tea, setting the teapot on the fender as she spoke, and she spoke resentful-like. "Any sensible man is afeard of ghosts," says she.
"Oh, indeed," said Margaret, catching her breath. "Is that so? Well, sensible or unsensible, this will be Halloween, hmm? And there's not a man in the parish would walk past the churchyard up to Corbett McCarthy's house where the banshee keened last night, except in my Dan'l," says she, triumphant.
Now, the hurt pride in Bridget O'Gill rose at that and forced her from her angry lips a foolish promise.
"Ho! Oh, we hear ducks talking,"
says Bridget, coolly rowling up Darby's stocking and sticking a needle in the ball of yarn.
"This very afternoon, I'll have you know, I was up at Cormac McCarthy's, and there wasn't a bit of tea in the house for poor little Eileen, so I promised Cormac I'd send him a handful. Now, by the same token, I promise you my Darby will make no bones of going on that errand this night."
"Ho, ho, ho, is that right?" laughed Margaret.
"If he has the courage to do it, bid him stop in to me on his way back, and I'll send you a fine set of eggs for my black Spanish hen."
What sharp word Mistress O'Gill would have flung back in answer, no one knows. Because when once provoked, she has the few equals for sarcastic language. But just as when Elizabeth Ann put in Bridget's hand a cup of steaming good strong tea. Now, whiskey, ale, and porter are all good for enough in their places, Your Honour, and I've nothing to intimidate against them, but for a comforting, soothing, edifying beverage, give me a cup of fine black tea. So this day the cups were filled only the second time, when the subject of husbands was completely dropped and the conversation wandered to the misdemeanors of Anthony Sullivan's goat. Now, all this time the women had been so busy with their talking and argifying that the creeping darkness of a coming storm had stolen unnoticed into the room, making the fire glow brighter and redder on the hearth. A faint flare of lightning, followed by a low grumble of thunder, brought the women to their feet.
"Oh, mercy on us," says Cecilia Crowe, glad of an excuse to be gone.
"Do you hear that? We'll all be drowned before we reach home," says she.
Now in a minute there was the visitors, and after draining their cups were out in the road, each hurrying on their separate way and tying her bonnet strings as she went. "'Twas a heavy and guilty heart that Bridget carried home with her through the gathering storm. Although Darby was intimate friends with the of the fairies, yet, as Margaret Doyle said, Darby did have a black dread of all other kinds of ghosts that to get him out on this threatening Halloween night. To walk past the churchyard, as he must do on his way to Corn McCarthy's cottage, was a job equal to the lifting of the Shannon Bridge it was. Now, how she was to manage it, she couldn't for the life of her tell. But if the errand was left undone, she'd be the laughing stock of every woman in the parish. The worst of all, and what cut Bridget's heart the sorest, was that she had turned an act of neighbourly kindness into a vainglorious boast, and that, she doubted not, was a mortal sin. Bridget had promised Cormac in the afternoon that as soon as she got home she would send Darby over with some tea for poor little Eileen, and now a big storm was gathering, and before she could have supper ready, try as hard as she could, a black night might be upon them. To bring ease to the dying, and is the comfortingest privilege a man or woman can have. And now I've traded it for a miserable setting of eggs, Bridget says to herself. Am not I the unfortunate creature, she thought, to have to let my pride ruin me this way? Oh, what will I do at all, she cried. Bad luck to the thought that took me out of my way to Elizabeth Ann Egan's house. And then Bridget made a wish that she might be able to get in home in time to send Darby on his errand before the night came on.
Oh, well, if the girls all laugh at me, that'll be my punishment, won't it? And maybe it'll clean my sin, she thought.
But Bridget's wish was in vain. For just as she crossed the stile to her own field, the sun dropped behind the clouds and the hills, as though it had been shot, and the east wind swept up, carrying with it a sky full of black clouds and rain. Now, that same All Souls night, Darby O'Gill, the friend of the fairy, sat as he had often sat before, amidst the dancing shadows, for an instant his own crackling turf and wood fire, listening to the storm beat against his cottage windows. Little Mickey, his 6-year-old, cuddled asleep on his daddy's lap while Bridget sat beside him. The other children cuddled around her. Oh my, how the rain powered and hammered and swirled. Out of the highway, the big drops smashed again wayfarers' faces like blows from a fist, and once in a while, over the fretted moors and the far row of lonesome hills, a sullen lightning spurted a red and angry like a vicious flare of a volcano. Now, you may well say it was perfect weather for Halloween. Tonight, when the spirits of the departed dead visit once again their homes and sit unseen, listening and yearning about the old hearthstones. More than once that evening, Darby shivered and shuddered at the wild shrieks and wails that swept over the chimney tops, he being certain sure that it was not the wind at all, but despairing voices that cried out to him from the cold lips of the dead. At last, after one particular doleful cry that rose and fell and lingered around the roof, the knowledgeable man raised his head and fetched a deep breath and said to his wife, Bridget, "Oh, do you hear that, Avonin? The dear Lord be merciful to the souls of the departed." Bridget turned a troubled face toward Darby.
"Oh, amen,"
Bridget says, speaking softly.
"And may he preserve them who are dying this night. Oh, poor Eileen McCarthy, and she the purty light-footed Colleen only married her for the few months, eh? Haven't we the reasons to be thankful and grateful, you and I, Darby? We can never pray enough, Darby," says she.
Now, the family just got off their knees from their night prayers that had lasted half an hour, so them were last words worried Darby greatly. That woman, Darby says to himself, mighty sour, referred to Bridget, of course, that woman is this minute contemplating and insinuating that we haven't said in prayers enough for Eileen, when as it is, me two poor knees have blisters on them as big as hen's eggs from kneeling, and if I don't look out, Darby says to himself again, she'll put the children to bed, and then she's down on her knees for another hour and me with her. Oh, I'd never advise anyone to marry such a pious woman. I'm fairly kilt with religion, so I am. I must distract her mind and prevent her intentions, Darby says to himself. "Hey, oh, maybe, Bridget," Darby says out loud as he was ready in his pipe. "Maybe it ain't so bad after all for Eileen. If we keep hoping for the best, we'll chase the worst out of a few good hours at any rate," says the knowledgeable man. But Bridget only rolled the apron about her folded arms and shook her head sorrowful at the fire. Darby squinted carefully down the stem of his pipe, blew in it, and took a sly glance at his wife and went on.
"Don't you remember, Bridget," Darby says, "when old Mrs. Rafferty lay sick of a bad inflammation of the stomach, eh? Well, the banshee sat for a full hour keenly crying before their house, just as it did last night outside Corbin McCarthy's. And you know the banshee cried but once at Rafferty's, but never returned for the second time. The inflammation left Julie, and all the wide world knows, even the King of Spain might know if he'd send an axe, that Julia Rafferty, as strong as a horse, was digging potatoes in her own field as late as yesterday. The banshee comes 3 nights before anyone dies, doesn't it, Daddy?"
says little Mickey, waking up all excited. "Oh, it does that," says Darby, smiling proud of the child's knowledgeableness. "And it's come but once to Eileen McCarthy."
Now, the clever listeners among ye may ask why the banshee would wail for a McCarthy.
Well, truth be told, Eileen is a Cavanaugh on her mother's side, ye see.
"And while the banshee cries, she sits combing her hair with a comb of gold, don't she, Daddy?"
Bridget sat uneasy, biting her lips. Always and ever, she had strove to keep from the children tidings of fairies and banshees and ghosts and other unnatural people. Twice she'd thrown a warning look at Darby, but he not noticed and went on stroking the little lad's hair and saying to him,
"Aye, it does indeed, Averick. And as she came but once to Mrs. Rafferty's, we have reason to hope she'll come no more to Cormac McCarthy's for Eileen." "You hush that noise," says Bridget, looking daggers. "Sure, Jack Doolin says 'twas no banshee at all come to Rafferty's, but only himself who'd taken a drop too much at the fair, and on his way home he sat down to rest himself by Rafferty's door. He says that he started singing pious hymns to keep off the evil spirit, and everyone knows that same Jack Doolin has a terrible voice for singing as any banshee that ever twisted a lip," says Bridget.
Now, the woman's contrariness vexed Darby, so he pounded his knee with his fist as he answered his wife.
Well, you'll not deny, maybe, he says, that the Costa Bower stopped one night at the hall and whish, 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 said Bridget. You leave off now, Darby. Sure, that's no kind of talk to be talking this night before the childers.
But, Mammy, I know what the Costa Bower is, cried little Mickey, sitting up straight in Darby's lap and pointing his finger at his mother. "'Tis I that knows well. The Costa Bower is a great black coach that comes in the night to carry the Crogamaha, the dead people that the Banshee keen for.
The other children by now are sitting bolt upright, stiff as ramrods, and staring wild-eyed at Mickey.
The coachman's head is cut off, and he holds the reins at this away,
says the lad, letting his hands fall limp and open at his sides.
Sometimes it's all visible, and then again it's invisible, but always when it comes to one can hear the terrible rumble of its wheels.
And Mickey's little voice fell, and spreading out his hands, he spoke slow and solemn.
In one Halloween night in the woods down at the Black Pond, Danny Hogan heard it coming, and he jumped behind a stone. The trees couldn't stop it, and they went right through it, and it passed Danny Hogan, and he says he saw one white dead face leaning back against the dark cushions, and this is the night. All Souls Night it is, when it's sure to be out. Now don't I know,
he says triumphant. At that, Bridget started to her feet. For a minute she stood speechless with vexation at the wild, frightening notions that had gotten into the heads of her children. And then, glory be, says Bridget, looking hard at Darby. You could have heard a pin drop in the room. Old Malachi, the big yellow cat, who until this time lay coiled asleep on a stool, was the best judge of Bridget's character in the house. So no sooner did he hear the words and Bridget start up than he was on his own 4 feet, his back arch, his tail straight up, and his 2 golden eyes searching for her face. One look was enough for him. The next instant Malachi leapt to the ground and started for the far room. As he scampered through the door, he threw a swift look back at his comrades, the children. And that look said plain as any words could say,
Run, run for it while you've the time. Follow me. Some of you vagabonds has done something murdering.
And Malachi was right. There would have been serious trouble for all hands, only that a softening thought on Bridget that night which sobered her temper. She stopped a bit, the frown on her face cleared as she looked at the children, and then she only said,
Bah, come out of this, youse. Back to bed with yous. I'm raising a pack of audacious young romancers, and I didn't even know it. Mickey, you stop that whimpering and make haste with your clothes. The Lord help us, he's broke off another button. Look at that now, she says.
Yeah, there was no help for them. And so with longing looks thrown back at their father, sitting cozy before the fire, and with consoling winks and nods from him, the children followed their mother to the bedroom. And then whilst Bridget was tucking the covers about them and hushing their complainings, Darby, with his elbows on his knees, doing in his head a sum in figures, and that sum was this. How much would it be worth, this All Souls Night, for a man to go out that door and walk past the churchyards up to Corrip McCarthy's, the stonecutter's house? Now at one time, Darby made the answer in his head as low as £10, 2 shillings and 3 pence. But as he did so, a particular loud blast went shrieking past outside in the storm, and he raised the answer to £1,520 sterling, and cheap at that, Darby said aloud. Now while Darby was studying them sagacious questions, Bridget stole quietly behind him and put a light hand on his shoulder. Now, for a minute then, neither of them said a word. Surprised at the silence, and puzzled that little Mickey had escaped a larrup, and Malachi crept from the far room and stood in the still doorway judging his mistress. An expression was on her face, and the cat could not quite make it out. 'Twas an elevated, pitying, good-hearted, determined look, such as a man may wear when he goes into the sty to kill one of his own pigs for Christmas. And Malachi, being a wise and experienced beast, decided to take no chances, so he backed through the door again and he hid under the dresser to listen.
I was just thinking, Darby, Avernine, says Bridget, half-whispering. I was just thinking how we might this blessed night earn a great credit for our 2 souls.
Wait now, says the sly man, straightening himself and raising a hand. The very thing you're going to say spake was on my mind, my dear. I was
just deliberating that I hadn't done justice tonight to poor Eileen. I haven't said me prayers fervent enough, and I never can when we're praying together or when I'm kneeling down here. And then, like everywhere else, there's something queer about me. The finest prayers I ever say is when I'm, by myself, alone in the fields, says the conniving villain. So do you, Bridget. You go in and kneel down by the children there for half an hour or so, and I'll sit here doing my best. If she should happen to look out and... I mean, you might easily think that I was only sitting here comfortably smoking my pipe. At the same time, prayers will be whirling inside of me like a windmill, says Darby.
Oh, then. Oh, Darby, ain't I glad and happy to hear you say them words,
says his wife, putting one fine arm about his neck.
You've taken a load off my heart that's been weighing on it all night, for I thought maybe you'd be afeard.
Afeard of what? Asked Darby, lifting his eyebrows. Malachi trotted boldly up and jumped up on the stool.
Well, Darby, you know what Father Cassidy says,
whispered Bridget.
That a love and deed of the hands done for the distressed is itself a prayer worth a week of common prayers.
I've nothing again that saying,
says Darby, his head cocked and growing suspicious. Bridget wiped her forehead with her apron.
Well, Darby, love, this afternoon I was at the McCarthy's house,
she went on, soothing his hair with one hand.
And, oh, the poor child Eileen was so distressed. Her cheeks were flaming with the fever. And Darby, the thirst, the awful thirst. Well, I looked about for a pinch of tea. There's nothing so cooling for one in the fever as a cup of weak tea, you know. And the sorest crap of it was in their house. And so, Darby, love, I told Cormac that tonight, as soon as the children were in bed, I'd send you over with a pinch of tea.
Now, every one of Darby's four bones stiffened and a mortal chill struck into his heart.
Now listen, darling,
says Bridget.
The storm's dying down, it is. And so while you're putting on your greatcoat, I'll wrap up the bit of tea.
Darby shook her hand from his shoulders.
Woman, says he with bitter politeness, I think you said that we had a great chance to credit for our two souls. That's what I think your remark can stipulate,
says Darby.
Oh, shouldn't a woman have great praise and credit who will send her husband out on such a night as this,
Bridget says.
The worse conditions, the more credit she'll be getting. If a ghost were to jump out at you, Darby, as you go past the churchyard, oughtn't I be the happy woman entirely, says Bridget.
Now there was a kind of tinkle in her voice, such as comes when Bridget is telling jokes. So Darby, with a sudden hope in his mind, turned quick to look at her. But there Bridget stood, grim and unfeeling and determined as a pointed gun.
Oh-ho! That's not the way it is, then, Darby says. Well, here's luck and good fortune to the ghost or skeleton that lays his hands on me this blessed night.
He stuck his two hands deep in his pockets and whirled one leg across the other, the most aggravating thing a man can do. But Bridget was not the least discouraged and only made up her mind to come at him on his soft side, so she spoke up and said,
Oh, Darby, suppose I was dying of the fever, Darby O'Gill, and Cormac refused to bring over a pinch of tea to me. What then would you think of the stonecutter?
Now Malachi, the cat, remember pick out Malachi? Malachi stopped licking his paws and thrown a sharp inquiring eye at his master.
Bridget, says the knowledgeable man, giving his hand an argifying wave,
we have two separate ways of being good. Your way is to scurry around and do good acts. My way is to keep from doing bad ones, you see.
And who knows, Darby says with a pious sigh, which way is the better one?
It isn't for us to judge, says he, shaking his head solemn at the fire.
Bridget walked out in front of him and folded her arms tight.
So, you won't go then,
she says, sharp and sudden.
The devil afoot, says Darby, beginning to whistle to himself.
Now you'd think now that Bridget was beat, but she still held her trump card, and until that was played and lost, the lad wasn't safe.
All right, me brave hero, says Bridget. Do you sit there by the fire, and I'll go myself, she says.
With that, she bounced into the children's room, and she began to get ready her cloak and hood. For a minute, Darby sat poking the fire, muttering to himself and feeling very discommodious. And then, just to show he wasn't the least bit uneasy, the lad cleared his throat and, wagging his head at the fire, he began to sing.
I walked out one morning all in the month of June. The primroses and the daisies and cowslips were in bloom. I spied a purty fair maid a-strolling on the lay, and Rory Borealis, nor any other old ancient heathen goddess, was not so fair as she. Says I, me purty fair maid, I'll take you for me bride, and if you pay no attention.
Glancing up sudden, he saw Malachi's eye on him, and if ever the features of a cat spoke silent but plain language, Malachi's face talked that minute to its master Darby. And this is what it said.
Well, of all the cowardly, creaking bostings I ever see in all me born days, you are the worst, Darby O'Gill. You not only give impudence to your wife, and she's worth four of you. But you've gone back on the friends you pretended to.
Malachi's features got no further in the insulting remarks,
for at that, Darby swooped up a big sod of turf and let it fly at the audacious beast.
Now, it is well known that, be a spontaneous troll like that, no one ever yet hit a sensible cat. But always and ever in that unlucky endeavor, he strikes a damaging blow, though it is not intended. And so it was this time. Bridget, wearing her red cloak and hood, was just coming through the door, and that misfortunate sod of turf caught her fair and square right below the chist, and she staggered back against the wall. Darby's consternation and complication interpretation were beyond imagination. Bridget lay there gasping. If she felt as bad as she looked, four Dublin surgeons with their saws and knives could not have done a ha'porth of good. Howsoever, for all that, the sly woman had seen Malachi dodge and go galloping away, but Bridget pretended to think 'twas at herself the turf was thrown from Darby. Not that she scolded or anything so common as that, but she went on like an early Christian martyr who was just going to be introduced to the roaring lions. Well, as you may easily see, the poor man, her husband, hadn't a chance in the world after that. And of course, to rightify himself, he'd face all the ghosts in Crogmaha. And so, in a minute, he was standing in his greatcoat with his hands on the latch. There was a packet of tea in his pocket, and Darby was a subdued and conquered man altogether. And so, woeful, he looked so woeful that Bridget repented and almost relented.
Now, remember, Darby Avernie,
she says mournful,
if I'm caught this...
yes. If I'm caught this night by the coast of Bower, by the Banshee, says Darby, you take good care of the children now, Bridget, and you remember what I say.
I didn't mean, Bridget, I didn't mean to hit you with that sort of turf. Oh, ain't ye the foolish darling to be afeard,
smiled Bridget back at him, but she was serious, too.
Don't you know that when one goes on an errand of mercy, a score of God's white angels with swords in their hands march before him, beside him, and after him, keeping his path free from dangers?
And with that, Bridget pulled her face down, his face down to hers, and she kissed him, as she used to, back in the old courting days. Yeah, well, there's nothing but so much high courage and clear, steadfast purpose in a man's heart if it be properly given as a kiss from the woman he loves. And so, with the warmth of that kiss to cheer him, Darby set forth into the storm. Chapter 2, The Banshee's Halloween. Halloween night. To all unhappy ghosts, it is about the same as St. Patrick's Day is to you or to me. 'Tis a great holiday in every churchyard, and no one knew this better or felt it keener than did Darby O'Gill on that same Halloween night as he stood in his own doorstep with a prop, with a paper of black tea for Eileen McCarthy safely stowed away in the crown of his top hat. And no one in that barony was quicker than he at an act of neighborly kindness, but now as he huddled himself together in the shelter of his own eaves, and the thought of the dangers before, and the cheerful fire and comfortable bed he was leaving behind, black rebellion rushed a shouting across his heart.
Oh my, what a perishing night to turn a man out into,
he says.
It'd be half a comfort to know I was going to be killed before I got back just a word into Bridget.
The mistreated lad turned a sour eye on the tumultuous weather, and he groaned deep as he pulled closer about his shoulders the cape of his greatcoat, and he plunged into the deserted and flooded roadway. Howsoever, it was not the pelting rain, nor the lashing wind, nor yet the pitchy blackness that bothered the heart out of him as he went splashing and stumbling along the road. A thought of something more relentless than the storm, more mysterious than the night's blackness, put pounds of lead into the lad's unwilling brogues. For somewhere in the shrouding darkness that covered McCarthy's house, the banshee was waiting this very minute, perhaps ready to jump out at him as soon as he came near. But oh, if the banshee nabbed him there, what in the world would the poor lad do to save himself? At the realization of this situation, the goose flesh crept up his back and settled on his neck and shoulders. He began to cast about in his mind for a bit of cheer, a scrap of comfort, as a man in such circumstances will. And so, grumbling and sore-hearted, Darby turned over Bridget's parting words.
Darby, if one goes on an errand of mercy,
Bridget had said,
a score of God's white angels with swords in their hands march before him and beside him and after him, keeping his path free from danger.
And so Darby felt anxious in his hat for a bit of charitable tea he was bringing,
He was glad to find it there, safe and dry enough, and though the rest of him was drenched through and through. Much like Brick's whiskey.
Hey, isn't this an act of charity I'm doing to be bringing a cooler drink to a dying woman? He asked himself aloud. To be sure it is. Well then, what reason have I to be afeard? Says he, poking his two hands into his pocket. Hurrah! It's easy enough to bolster up one's heart with a wise saying and heroic precepts, and when sitting commodious by one's own fire, but talking wise words to oneself is a mighty poor comfort when you're on the lonely high road of a Halloween night with a churchyard waiting for you at the top of the hill not 200 yards away. You know, there's only one star to break through the thick sky and shine for him. It was there with one friendly cow to lower a distant cock to break the teeming silence twould put some heart into that man. But not a sound was there, only the swish and wailing of the wind, the invisible hedges.
Ah, what's the matter with the whole world? Where's it all vanished to? Said Darby.
If a ghost were to jump at me from the churchyard wall, where would I look for help? To run is no use, he says. And to face it is.
And just then the current of his misdoubtings ran whack up against a saying of old Peggy O'Callaghan. Mrs. O'Callaghan's reputation for truth and veracity when it come to fairy tales or ghost stories, be it known, was equal if not superior to the best in Tipperary. Now, Peggy O'Callaghan had told Ned Mullen, and Ned Mullen had told Bill Donahue, the tinker, and the tinker had advised Darby that no one need ever be afeard of ghosts if he only had the courage to face them. Peggy said, "Oh, the poor creatures ain't roaming about shaking chains and moaning and groaning just for the sport of scaring people, nor yet out of meanness. It is always a trouble that's on their mind, you see. A message they want sent, a secret they're endeavouring to unload. So instead of flying from the poor unhappy ghost things, as most people generally do, one should walk up to the bold apparition and be it gentle or common, male or female, and say, 'Oh, what troubles you, sir? What's amiss with you, ma'am?' And take my word for it," says Peggy O'Callaghan, "you'll find yourself a bony factor to them when you least expect it."
It was a queer idea, to be sure, but not so unreasonable after all when one comes to think of it, and the knowledgeable man fell to deliberating whether he had have the hardness to folly it out if the chance came. Sometime he thought he would, and then again he thought sure that he wouldn't.
For Darby O'Gill was one who bent quicker under trouble, like a young tree before a hurricane, but he only bent, and the trouble never broke him. So at times his courage went down to a sparkle like light of a candle in a gust of wind. Before you turn your heel, he was up blazing strong and fiercer than ever before. Whilst thus contemplating and meditating, his foot struck the bridge in the hollow just below the burying ground. And there, as the boy paused a minute, turning up bravery enough to carry him up the hill and past the mysterious gravestones, there came a short quiver of lightning, and its sudden flare he was sure he saw not 10 yards away, coming down the hill toward him, a dim shape that took the breath out of his body.
"Oh, by the powers!" he gasped, his courage emptying out like water from a spilt pail.
It moved, a slow, grey, formless thing without a head, and so far as he was able to judge it might be about the size of an elephant. The persecuted lad swung himself sideways in the road, and one arm over his eyes, and the other stretched out at full length, as if to ward off his terrible visitor. And the first thing that began to take any shape in his bewildered brain was Peggy O'Callaghan's advice. Darby tried to follow it, but as a chattering of teeth was the only sound he made, and all this time a tremendous splashing like the flopping of whales was coming nearer and nearer to him, and the splashing stopped not 3 feet away, and the haunted man felt in the spine of his back and in the calves of his leg a powerful unholy monster towered over him, and why he didn't swoon in his tracks is the wonder. He says he would have dropped at last if it weren't for the distant bark of his own good dog, Caesar, that put a throb of courage into Darby's bones, and that friendly sound. He opened his two dry lips and he uttered this saying,
"Whoever you are, whatever your shape you come in, you take heed that I'm not afeard of you. I'm not, and I command you to tell me your troubles. I'll be your bony factor, I will. And then you go back decent and respectable where you're buried. You spake, and I'll listen," says Darby.
He waited for reply, and getting none, a hot splinter of shame at being so badly frightened turned his soul into vexation.
"Speak up," says Darby, "but come no further, for if you do but a hokey, I'll take one try at you, ghost or no ghost," says Darby.
Once more he waited, and as he was lowering his arm from his eyes for a peek, the ghost spoke up.
and his answer came in two pitiful, distressed roars.
Oh,
a damp breath puffed across his face and opened his eyes. What should the lad see but the two drooping ears of Solomon, Mrs. Kilcannon's grey donkey? Aye, five different kinds of disgust piled up in Darby's throat as it almost strangled him.
Oh, you murdering big-headed imposter, he gasped.
Half a minute after, a brown hoot owl, which was sheltered in a nearby blackcorn tree, called out to his brother's family, which inhabited the belfry of the chapel above on the hill, that some black-minded spalpeen had a hold of Solomon Kilcannon by the two ears and was kicking the ribs out of him, and that language the man was using to the poor beast was worse than scandalous. Although Darby couldn't understand what the owl was saying, he was startled by the blood-curdling hoot, and the same hoot saved Solomon from any further extraordinary frownsome, because as the Grangram man was stopped to hearken, there flashed on him the realization that he was baiting a cruel, multi-frightened, a blessing in disguise. For this same Solomon had the reputation of being the knowingest, sensiblest thing which walked on four legs in that parish, and he was a favorite with the young and old, especially with the children. And Mrs. Kilcannon said that she could talk to him as if he were a human, and she was sure he understood, and the face of Infax, the knowledgeable man, changed his tune, and putting his arm friendly around the distressed animal's neck, he said, "But aren't you ashamed of yourself? Solomon will be parading around and meandering around the churchyard Halloween night, disguising yourself this way as an outlandish ghost, and you having a fine reputation for decency and good manners and all," he says, excusing himself. "I'm ashamed of you, so I am, Solomon," says he, hauling the beast about on the road and turning him till his head faced one more on the hillside. "Come back with me now to Corin McCarthy's Aberneen, and we'd have each been in worse company, I'm thinking. At least you have, Solomon," says Darby. At that, kind and friendly enough, the forgiving beast turned with Darby, and the two, keeping each other slithering company, went stumbling and scrambling up the hill toward the chapel. Now on the way, Darby kept up a one-sided conversation about all manner of things, so the ring of the human voice, you know, was only his own, would take a bit of the cruel lonesome out of the dark hedges and the wet and cloudy night. "Say, did you notice MacDonald's stream as you came along the night, Solomon?" says Darby to the mule. "It must be roaring torrent by this time with the pouring rains, and we'll have to cross it," says he. "We could go over MacDonald's stone bridge and stand for Nance McCarthy's house with only Nolan's meadow betwixt the two, but..." "Aye, yeah, we could do that, but," says Darby, laying a hand confidential on the ass's wet back, "it's only a fortnight, isn't it, since the long Felix, the blind beggarman, fell from the same bridge and broke his neck, and what more natural," he asked, "than the ghost of Felix would be celebrating its first Halloween as a ghost at the spot where he was killed, right there on the bridge. Oh, I don't think we should be going that way. Oh, now you may believe it or believe it not, but at them words, Solomon stopped dead and still in his tracks and refused to go another step till Darby coaxed him on by saying, "Oh, then, if we won't cross if you're afeard, little man," he says to the donkey, "but we'll take the path through the fields on this side of it and across the stream on McCarthy's own wooden footbridge. 'Tis 20 feet of the house, and you needn't be afeard," Darby says again. "I've seen the cows across it, so it'll surely hold both of us." And then a sudden remembrance whipped into his mind of how tall the stile was leading into Nolan's meadow, and the boy was puzzling deep in his mind to know how was Solomon to climb across that stile when all at once the gloomy western gate of the graveyard rose quick by their side. Now the two, Darby and beast alike, shied to the opposite hedge, and no wonder they did. 50 ghosts, all in their shrouds, sat cheek by jowl along that churchyard wall, never caring a hayport for the wind or the rain. There was little Ted Rogers, the humpback, who was drowned in Mullins Well 4 years come Michaelmas. There was Black Mulligan, the gamekeeper, who shot Ryan the poacher, sitting with a gun on his lap, and he glowering beside the gamekeeper sat the poacher with a jagged black hole in his forehead. And there was Daddy Finnegan, the scholar, who was disappointed in love and died of a decline. And further on sat Mrs. Houlihan, who departed this life from eating of pies and mushrooms. And next to her sat, 100 others. Now, not that Darby saw them, do you mind? He had too good sense to look that way at all. He walked with his head turned out to the open fields and his eyes squeezed shut, but something in his mind told him that they were there all the less, and he felt in his,
in the marrow of his very bones, that if he gave them the encouragement of one glance, two or three, he'd slip off the wall and come moaning over to tell him their troubles.
What Solomon saw and what Solomon heard as the two went shrinking along well never be known to a living man, but once he gave a jump and twice, Darby felt him trembling, and when they reached at last the chapel wall, the beast broke into a swift trot, and pretty soon he galloped, and Darby went galloping along with him, till two yellow blurs of light across in the field to the left marked the windies of the Stonecutter's cottage. 'Twas a few steps only then to the stile over in Nolan's meadow, and there the two stopped, each looking helpless at each other. Solomon had to be lifted, and there was the trouble. Three times Darby tried by main strength to hoist his companion over the steps, but in vain, and Solomon was clean disgusted. Only for the tender corn on your hero's little, on our hero's left little toe, I think maybe that at length at last the pair would have got safe over. The kind-hearted lad had the donkey's two little hoofs planted on the top step, and whilst he himself was lifting the rest of the beast in his arms, Solomon got a bit uneasy, you see, and he was going to be thrown, and he so began to twist and squirm, and of course as he did, Darby slipped and went thump down on his back against the stile, with Hal Solomon sitting comfortable on top of the lad's chest. Oh, but that was not the worst of it, for as the beast scrambled up, he planted one hard little hoof on Darby's left foot, and the knowledgeable man let out a yell out of him that must have frightened all the ghosts within miles. Seeing that he'd done wrong, Solomon bolted for the middle of the road and stood there, wiry and attentive, listening to the names flung at him from where his late comrade sat on the lowest step of the stile, nursing his hurted foot. It was an excited owl in a belfry that this time spoke up and shouted to his brother down in the Blackhorn,
"Ooh, ooh, come up quick, ooh. Darby O'Gill is just after calling Solomon Kilcannon a malefactor, ooh."
Darby rose at last. And as he climbed over the stile, he turned to shake his fist toward the middle of the road.
"Bad luck to you, you thick-headed, ungrateful informer. You go your way and I'll go mine. We're sunders," says he.
And so saying, the crippled man went limping and grumbling down the boreen through the meadow, whilst his deserted friend set reproachful brays after him that would go to your heart. Now the throbbing of our hero's toe banished all pity for the beast and even all thoughts of the banshee for the moment, until a long gurgling swooping sound in front told him that his fears about the rise of MacDonald's stream were under rather than over actual conditions. Fearing that the wooden footbridge might be swept away as it had been the year previous, Darby hurried on. Now most times this little stream was only a quiet little brook that ran betwixt two purdy green banks with hardly enough water in it to turn the broken wheel and charter's ruined mill, but tonight it swept along angry and snarling, growling river that overleapt its banks and dragged wildly at the swaying willows. Being by a narrow throw of light from McCarthy's side window, our traveller could see the maddened weather striving and tearing to pull with its the props of the little footbridge, and the boards shook and the centre swayed under his feet as he passed over that bridge. "But dad'll not cross this way going home at any rate," Darby says, looking back at it. And the words were no sooner out of Darby's mouth than there was a crack in the middle of the footbridge, lifted in the air, twisted around for a second, then hurled itself into that stream, leaving the two ends still standing in their places on the banks. "Oh, thunder and turf!" Darby cried. "I mustn't forget to tell the people within of this, for if ever there was a trap set by evil spirits to drown a poor unwary mortal, there it stands. Oh, ain't a ghost terrible and wishes on Halloween?" And Darby stood there dripping a minute on the threshold, listening then, without knocking, and he lifted the latch and stepped softly into the house. The two candles burned above the blue and white chiny dishes on the table. A bright fire blazed on the hearth, and over in the corner where the low bed was set, the Stonecutter was on his knees beside it. Eileen lay on her side, her shining eyes shielded out on the pillow, shining hair shielded out on the pillow. Her pretty flushed face was turned to McCormick, who knelt with his forehead behind the bed covers. The Colleen's two little hands were clasped about the great fist of her husband, and she was talking low, but was so earnest that her whole life was in every word.
"God save all here,"
said Darby, taking off his hat, but there was no answer. So deep were Cormac and Eileen in some conversation they were having together that they didn't hear Darby coming in. The knowledgeable man didn't know what to do now. He realized that a husband and a wife about to part for, well, forever were looking into each other's hearts for maybe the last time. And so Darby just stood there, shifting from one foot to the other, watching them, unable to depart and unable to protrude.
"Oh, it isn't death at all that I fear,"
Eileen was saying.
No, no, Cormac Astore. 'Tis not that I'm misdoubtful of, but Cormac Vrohn. 'Tis you, I fear, Cormac, 'tis you.
Now the kneeling man gave one swift upward glance and drew his face nearer to the sick wife. She went on then, spaking tender and half smiling and stroking his hand.
I know, darling, I know well, so you needn't tell me that if I were to live with you 1,000 years, you'd never stray in mind or thought to any other woman, and but it's when I'm gone, when the lonesome evenings follow each other through days and months and maybe years, and you sitting there at this fireside without one to speak to, and you so handsome and grand, and with a penny or two we put away.
Oh, Astore MacLee, why can't you banish them black thoughts? Says the stonecutter. Maybe, he says, maybe the banshee will not come again, and ain't all the countryside praying for you this night, and didn't Father Cassidy himself bid you to hope? The saints in heaven couldn't be so cruel. But the colleen went on as though she hadn't heard him, or as if he had not interrupted her at all.
And listen, says Eileen, they'll come urging you, Cormac, the neighbours and Raisden with you. Your own flesh and blood will come, and no doubt me own with them, and they'll be striving to push me out of your heart and put another woman there in my place. I'll know it all, but I won't be able to call to you, Cormac MacLee, for I'll be lying silent under the grass or under the snow up behind the church.
Now, while she was saying them last words, although Darby's heart was melting for poor Eileen, his mind began running over the colleens of that townland to pick out the one who'd most likely marry Cormac in the end. You know how far-seeing and quick-minded was this knowledgeable man. He settled sudden on the Hanlon girl, and decided at once that she'd have Cormac before the year was out. And the audacity of such a thing made Darby furious at her. Darby says to himself, half crying, "Why then, bad cess to you for a shameless red-haired forward baggage, Bridget O'Hanlon, to be running after the man and throwing himself in his way, and Eileen not yet cold in her grave," says Darby. While he was saying them things to himself, McCarthy had been whispering fierce to his wife, but what it was the stonecutter said, the friend of the fairies couldn't hear. Eileen herself spoke clean enough in answer, for the favour gave her unnatural strength.
"And don't think," she says, "that it's the first time this thought has come to me. 2 months ago, when I was strong and well and sitting happy as a meadowlark at your side, the same black shadow drifted over me heart. The worst of it, and the hardest to bear of it all, is that they'll be in the right, Cormac, they'll be in the right. For what good can I do for you when I'm under the clay?" says she. "Oh, it's different with a woman. If you were taken and I was left, I'd wear your face and my heart through all my life and ask for no sweeter company."
"Eileen," says Cormac, lifting his hand, and his voice was hoarse as the roar of day, "I swear to you, on me bended knees—"
"No, no."
With her hand on his lips, Eileen stopped him from swearing whatever it was he was going to swear.
"They'll come on ye by degrees, a great craving for sympathy, a hunger and a longing for affection. You're just a man, and you'll have only the shadows of my poor vanished face to comfort you, and a recollection of a voice that's gone forever. A new warm face will keep pushing itself betwixt us."
"Aye, bad luck to that red-headed hussy," muttered Darby under his breath, looking around distressed. "I'll warn Father Casty of her and intentions on the day after the funeral." There was silence for a minute, and Cormac, the poor lad, was sobbing like a child. By and by, Eileen went on again, but her voice was failing, and Darby could see that her cheeks were wet.
"The day'll come when you'll give over,"
Eileen says.
"I see how it'll end. After that, you'll visit the churchyard by still, so as not to make the other woman sore-hearted again me."
Oh, my, isn't she the far-seeing woman, thought Darby.
"And then the little children'll come,"
Eileen says,
"and their soft, warm arms will hold you away, and by, you'll not go where I'm laid at all, and all thoughts of these few happy months we've spent together, oh, Mother in Heaven, how happy they were."
And the girl started to her elbow, for a sharp and sudden wild wailing cry just outside the window startled the shuddering darkness. It was a long cry of terror and of grief, not shrill, but piercing as a knife thrust. Every hair on Darby's head stood up and pricked him like a needle. It was the banshee.
"Listen, listen," says Eileen.
"Oh,
Cormac Astore is coming for me again."
And with that, stiff with terror, Eileen buried herself under the pillows. A second cry followed the first, only this time it was longer and rose and swelled into a kind of song that broke at last into the heartbreakingest moan that ever fell on mortal ears.
cold, oh, cold, it sobbed. The knowledgeable man, his blood turned to ice, his legs trembling like a hare, stood and looking in spite of himself at the black window panes, expecting some frightful vision. And after that second cry, the voice balanced itself up and down into the awful death keen, and one word made the whole song, and that terrible word was, forever, forever and ever, forever. Swung the wild queen keen, until all the deep meaning of the word burned itself in the Darby's soul, the heartbreaking sob, oh, cold, and dead was all the worse. Now Darby was just wondering whether he himself wouldn't go mad with fright, when he gave a sudden jump at a hard, strained voice which spoke at his very elbow. Darby O'Gill, it said, was a stonecutter who spoke. Do you hear the death keen? It came last night. It'll come tomorrow night at the same hour, and then, oh, my God. Darby tried to answer, but he could only stare at the white, set face and the sunken eyes of the man standing before him. There was, too, a kind of fierce quiet in the way McCarthy spoke that made Darby shiver. The stonecutter went on talking the same as though he was going to drive a bargain. They say you're a knowledgeable man, Darby O'Gill, and not on a time you spent 6 months with the fairies. Now I make you this square offer, says he, laying a forefinger in the palm of his other hand. I have 53 pounds that Father Cassidy's keeping for me. 53 pounds, he says again. And I have this good bit of a farm that my father was born upon, and his father was born on, and two, and the grandfather of him. And I have a grass of 7 cows. You know that, Darby. But, Darby, I'll give it all to you. Every stiver of it. If you'll only go outside and drive away that cursed singing banshee. He threw his head to one side, and he looked up anxious at Darby. The knowledgeable man racked his brains for something to speak, but all he could say was,
I brought you a bit of tea from the wife, Cormac.
McCarthy took the tea with unfeeling hands and went on talking the same dull way, only this time there came a hard lump in his throat now and that he had stopped to swallow. The 3 cows I go, I have go with it, of course, with the farm. So does the pony and the 5 pigs. I have a good plough and a fine harrow, but you must leave my stone-cutting tools right, so little Eileen and I can earn our way wherever we go, and this little creature hates at the best of times. The man's eyes were dry and blazing. No doubt his mind was cracked with grief. There was a lump in Darby's throat, too, but for all that he spoke up scolding-like.
"Or all talk raisin, man,"
Darby says, putting 2 hands on Cormac's shoulders.
If I had the wit or the art to banish a banshee, wouldn't I be happy to do it for not a farden to pay?
Well then, says Cormac, scowling and pushing Darby to one side, I'll just go face her myself. I'll face her and I'll choke that song in her throat if Satan himself stood at her side. And with those words, and before Darby could stop him, the stonecutter flung open the door and plunged out into the night. As he did so, the song outside stopped. Suddenly a quick splash in the feet, hoarse cries and shouts gave it tidings of a chase and the half-crazed gossoon that started up the banshee, and that there could be no manner of doubt. A remembrance of the awful things that she might do to his friend petrified the heart of Darby. And as I mentioned, we're running a little late. Probably, I don't know, 12 minutes more. I hope you can stay with us. Even after these cries died away, he stood listening for a full minute. The soles of his 2 brogues glued to the floor. The only sound he heard now were the deep ticking of a clock and a cricket that chirped slow and solemn on the hearth. And from somewhere outside there came the sorrowful cry of a whippoorwill. All at once, a thought of the broken bridge and the black treacherous waters caught him like a blow of a whip, and for a second drove from his mind even the fear of the banshee. In that 1 second, and before he realized it, Darby was out under the dripping trees and running for his life toward the broken bridge. The night was whirling and beating above him and flapping tremendous wings, but as Darby thought, he heard above the rush of the water and through the swish of wind and Cormac's voice crawling. The friend of the fairy stopped at the edge of the footbridge to listen. Although the storm had almost passed, a spiteful flare of lightning leapt up now and again out of the western hills, and after it came the dull rumble of distant thunder. The water splashed spitefully against the bank, and Darby saw that the 7 good feet of the bridge had been torn out of its center, leaving uncovered that much of the black deep flood. He stood straining his eyes and ears in wonderation, for now the voice of Cormac sounded from the other side of the stream, seeming to be floating toward him through the field over the path Darby himself had just traveled from the other side of the stream. At first he was mightily bewildered at what might bring Cormac on the other side of that brook,
till all at once the murdering scheme of the banshee burst in his mind like a gunpowder explosion. Her plan was plain as day. She meant to drown the stonecutter. She had led the poor, distracted man straight from his own door down to and over the new stone bridge, and was now deluding him on the other side of the stream, back again up the path that led to the broken footbridge. In the glare of a sudden blinding flash from the middle of the sky, Darby saw a sight he'll never forget to the day he dies. Cormac the stonecutter was running toward the death trap, his bared head thrown back, his two arms stretched out in front of him, a little above and just out of reach of them. Plain and clear as Darby ever saw his wife Bridget was the misty white figure of a woman. Her long waving hair streeled back from her face, and her face was the face of the dead. At the sight of her, Darby tried to call out a warning, but the words fell back into his throat. Then again came the stifling darkness. He tried to run away, but his knees failed him, so he turned around to face the danger. As he did so, he could hear the splash of the man's feet in the soft mud. In less than a minute, Cormac would be struggling in the water. At the thought, Darby braced himself, body and soul, let a warning howl out of him.
Hold where you are! She wants to drown ye! The bridge is broke! The bridge is broke in the middle!
But he could tell from the rushing footsteps and from the hoarse, swelling curses which came nearer him near every second, the deluded man, crazy with grief, was deaf and blind to everything but the figure that floated before his eyes. At that hopeless instant, Bridget's parting words popped into Darby's head.
When one goes on an errand of mercy, Darby, a score of God's white angels, had said Bridget, with swords in their hands, and march before and beside and after him, keeping his path free from danger.
Now, how it all came to pass, Darby could never rightly tell, for he was like a man in a dream, but he recollects well, standing on the broken end of the bridge, Bridget's words ringing in his ears, the glistening black gulf beneath his feet, and he swinging his arms for a jump. Just one thought of himself and the children, he gathered himself for a spring, and he cleared the gap like a bird. Yes, as Darby's two feet touched the other side of the gap, a terrific screech, not a screech either, but an angry, frightened shriek almost split his ears. He felt a rush of cold, dead air against his face, and he caught a whiff of newly turned clay in his nostrils, and something white stopped quick before him, and then with a second shriek, it shot high in the darkness and disappeared. Darby had frightened the wits out of the banshee. The instant after, the two men were clinched and rolling over each other in the down on the muddy bank, their legs splashing as far as the knees into the dangerous water, and Dart McCarthy raining weak blows in the knowledgeable man's head and breast. Darby felt himself going into the river. Bits of the bank caved under him, splashing into the current, and the lad's heart began clunking up and down like a churn dash.
"Leave off of me, leave off!"
he cried, as soon as he could catch his breath.
"Do you take me for a banshee, eh?"
says he, giving a desperate lurch and rolling himself on top of the other.
"Who are you, then, if you're not a ghost or the devil at any rate?"
gasped the stonecutter.
"Bad luck to ye!"
cried Darby, clasping both arms of the haunted man.
"I'm no ghost, let alone the devil. I'm only your friend, Darby O'Gill, aye."
Lying there, breathing hard, they stared in the faces of each other a little space till the poor stonecutter began to cry.
Oh, is that your Darby O'Gill? Where's the banshee? Oh, haven't I the bad fortune," he says, striving to raise himself.
"Rise up, man," says Darby, lifting the man to his feet and steadying him there. The stonecutter stared about him like one stunned by a blow.
"I don't know where the banshee flew off to, but do you go back to Eileen as soon as you can,"
says the friend of the fairies.
"Not that way, man alive," he says, as Cormac started to climb the footbridge. "It's broke in the middle, man. Go down and cross the stone bridge. I'll be after you in a minute."
Without a word, meek now and biddable as a child, Cormac turned and Darby saw him hurry away into the blackness. Now, the reasons that Darby remained behind were two. First and foremost, he was a bit vexed at the way his clothes were muddied and draggled, and he himself had been pounded and hammered, and second, he wanted to think. He had a queer cold feeling in his mind that something was wrong, a kind of foreboding, one might say. As he stood thinking, a realization of calamity struck him all at once like a rap on the jaw. He had lost his fine briar pipe. The lad had groaned as he began the anxious search. He slapped furiously at his chest and his side pockets. He dived into the trousers and greatcoat, and at last, sprawling on his hands and feet like a monkey, he groped savagely through the wet and sticky clay. "This comes," says the poor lad, grumbling and groping, "of poking your nose in other people's business. Hello, what's this?" he says, straightening himself.
"'Tis a comb, by the powers of pewter,"
It's the Banshee's comb.
And so indeed it was. Darby had picked up a gold comb the length of your hand and almost the width of your two fingers. About an inch of one end of it was broken off and then dropped into Darby's palm. Without thinking, he put the broken bit into his waistcoat pocket and he raised the biggest half close to his eyes, the better to view it. And for those of you here in the Glen NSL, the clever ones, you may search about and find that very same comb sitting somewhere. May I never see sorrow, he says, if the Banshee must have dropped her comb. Look at that now. Folks do be saying that this gives her the fine singing voice because the comb is enchanted, Darby says. If that saying be true, it's a famous lad I am from this night. I'll travel from fair to fair, and maybe at the end they'll send me to Parliament. With these words, Darby lifted his caubeen and stuck the comb in the top tuft of his hair. Yes, there was a comb here in the Kitely Glen, too, but someone ran off with it. We'll find one for next week. McGore. Darby had no sooner given a pull than a sour, singing feeling began at the bottom of his stomach, and it rose higher and higher. And when it reached his chest, he was just going to let a bawl out of himself, only that he caught sight of a thing for an instant that froze the marrow in his bones. Of course you did, Dagmar. He gasped, though. Surprised Rick didn't beat you to it. He gasped short and jerked the comb out of his hair, for there, not 10 feet away, stood a dark and shadowy woman, tall, thin, and motionless, leaning on a crutch. Now, during a breath or two, the persecuted hero lost his head completely, for he never doubted that the Banshee had changed her suit of clothes to chase back after him. The first clear emotion that returned to him was to fling the comb on the ground and make a bolt of it. But on second thought, he knew that it would be easier to beat the wind in a race than to run away from the Banshee. Well, there's a good Tipperary man done for this time, groaned the knowledgeable man, unless in some way I can beguile her. Now, Darby was fishing his mind for its civilest word when a woman spoke up, and Darby's heart jumped in gladness as he recognized the cracked voice of Sheila Maguire, the spy for the fairies.
Top of the evening to you, Darby,
says Sheila, peering at him from under her hood, the two eyes of her glowing like tallow candles.
Am I killed with astonishment to see you here this alone this time of night, says the old witch.
Now, the clever man knew as well as though he had been told that when Sheila said them words that the Banshee had sent her to look for the comb, and his heart grew bold, but he answered her polite enough. Why then, luck to you, Mistress Maguire, ma'am, Darby says, bowing grand. Sure, if you're killed with astonishment, and I split with incredulity to find yourself meandering in this lonesome place on Halloween night. Sheila hobbled a step or two nearer and whispered confidential-like.
Well, I'd wandering hereabouts only this morning, she says. And I lost from me here a gold comb. I lost it, I did. One that I've had these 40 years. Did you see such a thing as that, Agra?
And her two eyes blazed. Fay, I don't know.
Maybe you should ask Dagmar or Zephod,
says Darby, putting his two arms behind him.
Was it about the length of your hand and the width of your two fingers? He asked.
It was,
says Sheila, thrusting out a withered paw.
Oh, then I didn't find it,
says the tantalizer man.
But maybe I did find something similar, only it wasn't yours at all. Wasn't yours at all, Sheila Maguire, but the Banshee's.
Now, whether the hag was intending to weld Darby with her staff, or whether she was only lifting it to make sign of enchantment in the air, will never be known. But whatsoever she meant, the hero doubled his fists and squared off. At that, she lowered the stick and broke into a shrill and cackling laugh. She laughed, holding her sides.
But aren't ye the bold and distinguishable man, hmm? Because, of course, it is the Banshee's comb. Well, you know it. By the same token, I'm sent to bring it away. So make haste to give it up, Darby O'Gill, for she's hiding and waiting for me down at Charter's Mill. Aren't you the courageous blackguard to grovel at her and try to catch her? Shoo, such a thing never happened before since the world began, says Sheila.
Now, the idea that the Banshee was hiding and feared to face him was great news to the hero, but he only tossed his head and smiled superior as he made answer.
"'Tis yourself that knows well, Sheila Maguire, ma'am,'
answers back the proud man, slow and deliberate,
"'that when one does a favour for an unearthly spirit, he may demand for pay the favours of three such wishes as the spirit has the power to give. The world knows that. Now I'll take three good wishes, such as the Banshee can bestow, or else I'll carry the golden comb straight to Father Cassidy. The Banshee hasn't gold nor worldly goods, as the saying is, but she has what suits me better.
Now this cleverness angered the fairy woman, so she sent in to abuse and to frighten Darby. She ballyragged, she browbait, she traduced, she threatened, but 'twas no use. The bold man held firm until at last she promised him the favours of three wishes from the Banshee.
Good, 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 then. First and foremost, says Darby, I want her never to put her spell on me or any of my kith and kin. Aye, that wish she gives you, that wish she grants you, though it'll go sore agin the grain, snarled Sheila. Ah, then, says Darby, my second wish is that the black spell be taken off of Eileen McCarthy.
Sheila flushed around like an angry hen.
Wouldn't something else do as well, she says. I'm not here to argify,
says Darby, swinging back and forth on his toes.
Bad scraying to you, says Sheila. I'll have to go and ask the Banshee about that. Don't stir from that spot until I come back, men.
We're getting really close, really. Now, you may believe it or not, but with that saying, she bent her head on her crutch well forward, and before Darby's very face, she threw, saving your presence, one leg over the stick as though it had been a horse, and while one might say Jack Robinson, the crouch rose into the air and lifted her, and she went sailing out of sight. Darby, well, don't let the Banshee know you've got it, Asnana. Darby was still gaping and gawping at the darkness when she disappeared, when whisk, she was back again and dismounting at his side.
The luck is with ye, says Sheila, spiteful. That wish I give ye, that wish I grant ye, you'll find seven crossed rushes under McCarthy's doorstep. Uncross them, put them in fire, in water, and the spell is lifted. Be quick with the third wish, out with it.
Well, I'm in a more particular hurry about that than you are, says Darby. You must find me Briar Pipe, says he.
You overdone, sneered the fairy woman. Just stuck in the band of your hat where you put it when you left your own house that night. No, no, not in front, she says as Darby put his hand to feel. It's stuck in the back. Your cobbeans twisted.
Now, whilst Darby was standing there with the comb in one hand and his pipe in the other, smiling delighted, the comb was snatched from his fingers and he got a welt in the side of the head from the crutch. Looking up, he saw Sheila 20 feet in the air heading for Charter's Mill and she cackling and screeching with laughter. Rubbing his sore head and muttering unpious words to himself, Darby started for the new bridge. In less than no time after, he had found the seven crossed rushes under McCarthy's doorstep and had flung them into the stream. And then, without knocking, he pushed open McCarthy's door and tiptoed quietly in. Cormac was kneeling beside the bed with his face buried in the pillows, as he was when Darby first saw him that night. But Eileen was sleeping as sound as a child, with a sweet smile upon her lips, heavy perspiration beaded her forehead, showing that her favour was broke. Without disturbing either of them, our hero picked up the package of tea from the floor, put it on the dresser, and with a glad heart, strolled out of the house and closed the door softly behind him. Turning towards Charter's Mill, he lifted his hat and bowed low.
"But thank you kindly, Mistress Banshee," he says. "'Tis well for us all I found your comb this night, public or private. I'll always say this for you. You're a woman of your...
Aye?
Oh. Aye, you're a woman of your word. What's this in my pocket?
And that's our halfway point for the story, so hit pause and take a break if you need to and hurry back. This is the same Darby of Disney fame, but it is not the story in the movie. The movie draws on numerous of the Darby O'Gill stories written by Hermione Cavanaugh, and of which his brief encounter with the Banshee in the movie is just one of them. In this story, Darby finds the end of part of a comb. Yep, a whole comb, like brushing your hair with, that later turns out to belong to the Banshee. In her attempts to locate the missing piece of that comb, the Phantom Woman summons up a host of ghosts and from the graveyard to sweep through the countryside and towns looking for it. And if you want to know how Darby O'Gill escapes, well, hey, stick around. If you'd like to read along, because it is in the vernacular, which is a little weird to listen to, I'm going to do my best to maintain authenticity and yet still be, you know, able to be understood. However, if you'd like to read along, there's a link there in local chat, and we're beginning on page 240 tonight. Tonight's story is just a bit long, but not quite as long as part one. So, depending how fast I talk, we should wrap up by 8:15 or so. So, on with the story. Yeah. When we last met, 'twas Halloween night, and Darby O'Gill had gone out in a tremendous storm to take a bit of black tea to Eileen McCarthy's house to help comfort her in her final dying hours. Despite his professed opinions against meddling or moiling in the affairs of fairies, Darby got himself tangled up with the banshee that stormy night and found her comb laying on the ground, and now the banshee cannot conduct her business of wailing for dying souls unless she's combing her hair while she does it. So she demanded Darby return that comb to her. In return, Darby, knowledgeable man that he is, demanded his three rightful wishes before returning it to her. First and foremost, he wished, I want you never to put your spell on any of me or my kith or kin. And my second wish, says the knowledgeable man, my second wish is that the black spell be taken from Eileen McCarthy. And so Eileen escaped certain immediate death. And thirdly, I want me briar pipe back. Now, for a little while after Darby O'Gill sent the banshee back her comb, well, there was duckins to pay in that townland. Each night came stormier than the others. And the rain, oh, never since Noe the Phoenician hoisted sail for Ariat was there promised such a denuderant flood. In one way or another, we're all, even the German men in the far downs, descendants of the Phoenicians, aren't we? Even at that, the foul weather was the least of the troubles. The countryside road was haunted. The entire countryside was haunted. And every ghost must have left Crogmaw as soon as twilight to wander abroad in the lonesome places. The farmyards and even the village itself was not safe in those stormy days and nights. One morning, just before cockcrow, Big Joey Hooligan, the smith, woke up and with a sudden terrible feeling that some ghastly person was a-looking at him through the window. And starting up and flurried in bed, what did he see but two eyes that were burning like coals of fire and peering steady into the room? One glance was enough. Giving a tremendous gasp, Joey dropped back quaking into the bed and covered his head with the bedclothes. How long after that the two hideous eyes kept staring at the bed, Joey can't rightly tell, for he never uncovered his head nor stirred hand nor foot again till his wife, Nancy, had lighted the fire and boiled the stirabout. Now indeed, though it was a good month after that, before Joey found courage enough to get up first in the morning so as to light the fire. And on that same memorable morning, he and Nancy lay in bed argifying about it till nearly noon. The poor man was that frightened. Now that evening, after Hooligan was visited, Mrs. Nora Clancy was in the stable milking her cow, Cornelia by name, when suddenly she spied a tall and strange man in a topcoat standing near the stable door, and he with his back turned towards her. At first she thought it was a shadow, but it appeared a trifle thicker than a shadow, and so a little feared, he called out, God save you, kind sir. At that, the shadow turned a dim gray face toward her, so full of reproachful woe that Mrs. Clancy let a screech out of her and tumbled over the pail of milk betwixt her knees. She lay on her back in the spilt milk, unconscionable, for a full 15 minutes. And no, I don't think she was crying, even though she did spill the milk, because, you know, she was unconscious. Now, the next night, a very reliable thinker. Take that back, Freudian slip, that is. A very reliable tinker, who is not indeed a great thinker, a tinker named Bothered Bill Donahue, while wandering near the Charter's ruined mill, came quite in accidental upon 20 skeletons. And they were colloquying and confabbing together on the flat roof of the mill shed. But worst of all, and something that struck deep terror in every heart, was the news that 6 different persons at 6 different places had met with the terrible phantom coach, the Costa Bower. Now, Peggy Collins, a wandering beggar woman from the West Country, had a wild chase for it, as if she'd been a second later reaching the chapel steps and laying her hand on the church door. Well, it would have had Peggy for sure, I'm saying. Now, things got on so that after dark, people only ventured out in couples or in crowds, and
pint of a piety that the parish was grown into an example of and patron for the nation, despite the sogginess of the lands thereabout. But all of the persons whom them conditions complicated, you may be sure the worst harried and implicated was the knowledgeable man, Darby O'Gill. Now there was a weight on poor Darby's mind, and he couldn't tell why, and a dread in his heart that had no reasonable foundation. He moped and he moothered. Some of the time he felt like singing doleful ballads and death keens, and just the time he could hardly keep from crying. His appetite left him, but what confused him worse than all the rest was the fondness that had come over him for hard work, cutting turf and digging potatoes and you know, things like that. The hard work that Darby is just not generally prone to. Now, to make matters even more unsociable, Darby's friend Brian Connors, the king of the fairies, hadn't showed a nose inside Darby's door for more than a fortnight, and so the knowledgeable man had no one to advise with. In them dismal circumstances, Darby's growing desperate, harnessed the poor Cleopatra one morning and drove up to Clonmel to see the master doctor. The renowned McNamara. Be this, you may know how bad he felt for no one till he was almost a pint of desolation ever went to see that crass, browbeaten old codger. So loath enough was our hero to face him, and hard-hearted enough was the welcome the crabbed little doctor held out to Garby when they met.
"Me went to eat for breakfast,"
the physician says, peering savage from under his great eyebrows at Darby's tongue. "Oh, you were only as a bowl of stir about. Well, a couple of potatoes, and a bit of bacon, and a few eggs," and he was counting on his fingers, and something or other I forgot. "And another thing, too. Do you think I'll go into decline, Dr. McGraw?" Turning immediate to his medicine table, the surgeon began studying the medicines. Now, there was so much of it for an instant, he might have given a gallon and never missed it. Now, there was one fine big red bottle in particular that Darby had his eye on, and he thought his dose had surely come out of that. But McNamara turns to a box the size of your hat, and it filled to the top with little white pills. Well, the stingy old rascal counts out three and hands them to Darby, says,
"Yeah, you take one before breakfast, another before dinner, and the last one before supper, and then you give me 4 silver shillings, and that'll cure ye."
Be sure that Darby biled up inside with the madness of the unreasonableness of the price of the pills, but hold himself in, he says, very cool and quiet, "Hey, will you write me out a receipt for the money then, Dr. McNamara, if you please?" Darby says, and whilst the old chatter is, you know, turned to the writing, be the whole pills from that box. And by means of those pills, as he drove along home, he was able to do a power of good to the neighbor people he met with on the road. Now, when you once get into the habit of it, there's no pleasure in life which equals giving other people medicine. Darby generously made old Peggy Callahan take 6 of the little round things. He gave a swally to half-witted Red Durgan and a good mouthful to poor, sick Eileen McCarthy, only she was as good. And he gave a fistful each to Judy Rafferty and Dennis Hogan, and he stood handsome threat to a stranger who, the minute he got the taste well into his mouth, he wanted to fight Darby. Howsomever, the two only called each other hard names for a while, and Darby jogged along, doing good and growing lighter-hearted and merrier-minded at every stop he made. But 'twas this way with Darby, till just in front of Mrs. Kilcannon's, who should Darby see, scratching himself against the wall, but Solomon, and the beast looking bitter, denunciation out of the corner of his eye. Darby turned his head, ashamed to look the mistreated donkey in the face. And worse, beyond Solomon, leaning against the same wall, was Bother Bill Donahue, the deaf tinker. That last sight dashed Darby entirely, for he knew as well as if he had been told that the tinker was laying wait with him for a night's lodging. Now, it wasn't that Darby objected on his own account to taking him home, for a tinker or a beggar man, mind you, has a right the world over to claim a night's lodging and a bit to eat wherever he goes, and well, these honest people pay for it, don't they? In the gossip and the news they furnish at the fire, itinerant storyteller is one of this clan, isn't he? Anyway, Darby liked well to have them come, but through some unknown weakness in character, Darby's darling Bridget hated the sight of them. Worst of all, Bridget hated Bothered Bill. She was okay with Osnana,
fact, I think she liked Dunstanna, but Bothered Bill, she flat out hated Bothered Bill. She even went so far as to say that Bill was not half so bothered as he pretended, and that he could hear well enough that what were him to hear, and that he was deaf only because he did like to listen to. Well, anyhow, there was a tinker in the road waiting for the cart to come up, and for a while what to do Darby didn't well know. He couldn't refuse one who asked Bill home. By a bit of length then, at last Darby decided with a sigh to put the whole case before Bill and let him come or stay. And so whilst he was meditating on some way of conveying the news that they'd be complimentary to the tinker, and then they'd elevate instead of smack, "I'll get going home with you tonight, I think so, I think yes." The tinker, like most people who are hard of hearing, roared as though the listener was bothered in the lines and hilted out a handful of the little reticence.
"Well, there's nothing the matter with me. Why should I eat them?" cried Bill.
"They're the best thing in the world for that," says Darby,
forcing them into Bill's mouth.
You don't know when you'll need them," he says, shouting. "It's better to meet sickness halfway," he says, "than to wait till it finds you."
And then Bill, with an open hand against his ear, was chawing the pills and looking up plaintive into Darby's face, the knowledgeable man went on in a blandished situation.
"So, you see, 'tis this way, Wollum," he says. "It's only too delighted I'd be to take you home with me."
"Indeed, good luck to her then, and ain't I glad to have so fine an opinion from so fine a woman. But sure, all the women notice how tidy I am, and that's why they like to have me in the house. But we best be moving now," says he, coolly dropping his bags of tools into the Darby's cart, "for the night's at hand, good fellow," says he. But the diff man only pocketed the shilling and clambered up onto the seat beside Darby.
"Oh, faith, the shilling's welcome, yeah, to give without your paying me," he says, patting Darby kindly on the back.
But Darby's jaw was hanging for the loss of the shilling right on top of the unwelcome visitor.
Wait, we better hurry," says the tinker, lighting his pipe,
"for after sundown, who knows what'll catch up with us on the road." Well, sure, there was nothing for it but to make the best of a bad bargain, and the two went on together, Darby gloomy and vexed, and the deaf man solemn but comfortable, till they were almost at McHale's.
"Darby, no," says Darby. What in the world ails Sheila Maguire against anybody else for that matter, Darby? Only that last Halloween night, Sheila Maguire was beat black and blue from head to foot, and she lays that responsibility on you, Darby O'Gill."
Now the had his mouth open for a question when who should go running across the road in front of them but Neddy McHale himself, in his arm waving an arm wild.
The bridge of Butterworks are bashed out by the flood, and McDonald's bridge is down too, so you must go round by the mill," says Neddy.
Now, here was bitter news for you. 'Twas 2 miles out of the way they could be going to Charter's Mill, and to do the best possible they'd pass on that haunted place in the pitch dark. "Now, faith, I've had worse luck than in picking you up this night, Bothered Bill," Donahue says Darby, "for it's a loath I'd be good to go alone past Charter's Mill, so I'll have to have you with me, Bill." He turned to speak just in time for this. The tinker gathered up his bag and put his right foot on the cartwheel, preparing for a jump. The lad by the back of his neck and jolted him back hard into the seat.
"You sit still there, Willem, till we reach me own house, Savernine. For if you try that move again, I'll not leave a whole bone of your body."
"Oh, Mr. O'Gill, I think I'll stop the night with Minnie McHale," says Willem, shivering. "Bridget don't think I'm clean," he says, as the pony started off.
"Well, who told you that, I'd like to know?" Darby shouted, growing fierce. "Who dared say that of you? But you're bothered, Willem, you know, and so you must interpret language."
But Bill only cowered down sulky, and the pony galloped down the side lane into the words and striving to beat the rain in the darkness. But the elements were too swift-footed, weren't they? And the rain came down, and the shadows met together in the dusk whirled quick gloomy mill. Ever and always Charter's Mill was in a misfortunate place. It broke the heart of... Now many was the wild tale known through the countryside of the things that had been seen and heard at Charter's Mill. But the tale that kept Darby and the tinker unwelcome company as the pony trotted along was what had happened here a couple of years before. One night, as Paddy Keller was driving past the gloomy old place, his best ear cocked and his weather eye open for ghosts, there came sudden from the mill 3 agonized shrieks for help. Thinking 'twas the spirits that were in it, Paddy whipped up his pony and hurried on his way. But the next morning, misdoubting whether 'twasn't a human voice after all he had heard, Paddy gathered up a dozen of the neighbors and went back to investigate.
And what do they find in one of the upper rooms but a peddler, lying flat on the floor, his pack ransacked, as he dead as a doornail. Now, what's to be particularly considered dead about that particular piece of ironmongery, I'm not sure. But there he was, dead as a doornail. 'Twas his cries Paddy had heard that the poor traveller was being murdered. Now, since that time, a dozen people passing the mill at night had heard the cries of the same peddler, and had seen the same place blazing with lights. So that now no one who could help had ever passed alone next the mill after dark. At the hill this side of that place, the pony slowed down to a walk, and neither coaxing nor beating could induce the beast to mend his steps. The horse would stop a little and wait, and then he'd go on and trembling, and they could all see in the dim outlines the empty mill glowering up at them, and nearer them they came, the more it glowered, and the faster their two hearts beat. Halfway down the hill, an old signpost pointed the way with his broken arm just beyond that bridge, and after that long, level road, and salvation, if they'd make it that far. But at the signpost, Cleopatra stopped dead still, stared into some bushes just beyond. She was shaking and snorting, and her limbs were trembling. At the same time, to tell the truth, she was no worse off than the two Christians sitting in the cart behind her, only they were not so demonstrative about it. Small blame to the lads of that, for they were sure and certain that lurking in the black shadows was a thing waiting to freeze their hearts in terror, and maybe to put a mark on them they'd carry to their graves. After coaxing Cleopatra and reasoning with her in vain, Darby, his knees and knocking, turned to the tinker, and in the excitement of the events, forgetting that Bill was deaf, he whispered, as cool and easy-like as he could, "Hey, would you mind doing me the favour of stepping out of Vic and seeing what's in that road ahead of us, Willem?" But Bothered Bill answered back as once, just as cool and easy, "I would mind, Darby, and I wouldn't get down a store to save your and your family and all their lineal descendants from the gallus rope," says he. "I thought you was deaf," says Darby, growing respectful. "Disrespectful, that is." "This is no time for explanations," says Willem. "And I thought myself," he went on, turning his shoulder to Darby, "that I was in the company with a brave man, but I'm sorry to find that I'm riding with no better than an outrageous coward," he says bitter. Whilst Willem was saying them vexatious words, Darby stood leaning out of the cart with a hand on Cleopatra's back and a foot on the shaft and goggling his eyes and striving to pierce the darkness at the pony's head. Without turning around, he made answer, "Well, as that the way with it is with you then, Willem," he says, still sarcastic. "Faix, then, ye'll have that complaint no longer. If yez don't climb down this minute, I'll throw you and your baggage in the ditch. So get out immediate, darling, or I'll throw you out," he says. Yeah, the words weren't well out of Darby's mouth when the audacious tinker whipped out his scissors and sent the sharp pint of half an inch into Cleopatra's flank. Cleopatra jumped, and Darby, legs and arms a-flying, took a back somersault that he never equaled in his supplest days, for it landed him flat against the hedge, and the leap Cleopatra gave, if she could only keep it up, fitter for the Curragh races, and keep it up for surprise and while she did. At any rate, for as the knowledgeable man scrambled to his feet, he could hear her furious gallop 100 yards down the road.
"Stop! Stop her, Willem of Aberneen! I was only joking! Come back! Come back! You shameless rogue of the universe! I'll have you transported!"
Darby shouted, rushing a few steps after them. But the lash of the whip on Cleopatra's sides was the only answer Willem sent back to him. To pursue was useless. And so the deserted man slacked down to a trot. Now I'd hate bad to have before me any one of the 100 things Darby wished aloud then and there for Willem. Well, at all events, there was Darby, his head bent, plodding along through the storm, and fiercer storm than any wind or rain ever met again, raging in his heart. Only through that storm in his mind there flared now thin quivers of fear, interpretation that sometimes hastened his steps, and then again, sometimes they faltered him. Howsomever, taking it all in, he was making good progress, and had got to a bunch of willows at the near side of the mill, when one particular remembrance of Sheila Maguire and of the Banshee's comb halted the lad in the middle of the road and sent him fumbling with nervous hands in his waistcoat pocket. And there, sure enough, was the piece of the Banshee's comb. Now the broken bit had lain forgotten in the lad's pocket since Halloween,
and now as he felt it there next his thump and hard and buried under a pipe full of tobacco, the realization almost floored him with consternation, and all rushed over Darby's soul like a flood. Who else could it be but the banshee that gave Sheila Maguire that terrible beating mentioned by the tinker? And what was that beating for, unless the banshee accused Sheila of stealing the end of the comb? Oh, and Mother of Moses, 'twas searching for that same bit of comb it was that brought up the ghosts and the storms from Croagh Maw and made the whole townland haunted. Ah, well, was there ever such a dangerous predicament? Here Darby was, with ghosts in the trees above him and in the hedges and maybe looking over his shoulder, and all of them, mind you, searching for the bit of the enchanted comb that was in his own pocket. If they should find out where it lay, that awful, what awful things they would be doing to Darby. Sure, they might call up the coast of Bower and fling him into it, and that'd be the last ever heard of Darby O'Gill in the land of the living. With them wild thoughts jumping up and down in his mind, Darby stood in the dark and in the rain and the flashing lightning and gawman vacant over toward the shadowy ruin. And he, being much agitated, the lad, without thinking, did the foolishest thing a man in his situation could well accomplish. He took out of his pocket the enchanted sliver of gold and held it to his two eyes for a look. The consequences came sudden, for as Darby stuck it back into the tobacco, there burst from the darkness of the willows the hollowest, most blood-curdling laugh that ever fell on mortal ears. The knowledgeable man's hair lifted the hat from his head, as if the laugh wasn't enough to scatter the wits of everyone. At the same instant it sounded, and quick as a flash, every window in the old mill blazed with a fierce blue light, every battered crack and crevice seemed bursting with the glare for maybe the space of 10 seconds, and then, oh, Amelia Murther, there broke from the upper floor three of the bitterest shrieks of pain and terror ever heard in the world, and with a last cry the mill quenched itself into darkness again and stood lonely and gloomy and silent as before. The rain pattered down, and the wind swished in the mournful trees, and there was no other sound. The knowledgeable man turned to creep away very soft and quiet, but as he did, a monstrous black thing that looked like a dog without a head crawled slowly out from the willows where the terrible laugh had come from, and it crept into the gloom of the opposite hedge, and there it stood waiting for Darby to draw near. But the knowledgeable man gave a leap backwards, and as he did, from the darkness just behind him swelled up a deep sigh that was almost a groan. From the hedge to his right came another sigh, and only deeper than the first, and from the blackness on his left rose another moan, and then moaning choruses rose all about old Darby, and lost himself in the wailing of the wind, and he was surrounded. Aye, the ghosts had captured Darby O'Gill. Now the lad never realized before that minute what a precious thing is daylight. If there would only come a flash of lightning to show him the faces of the surrounding spirits, horrible though they might be, he'd bid it welcome. But though the rain drizzled and the thunder rumpled, not a flare lit up the sky. One swift, desperate hope at the last minute saved the boy from sheer despair, and that same hope was that maybe some of the good people might be flying about and would hear him. So lifting up his face to the sky and crying out to a passing wind, he says, "Boys! Hi, lads!" says he. If there be any of yes to listen, I'll take it as a great favour, and I'll thank you kindly to tell King Brian Connors that his friend and comrade Darby O'Gill is in deep trouble and wants to see him immediate. Oh, lads, I hope you can hear me."
"Oh," laughed the terrible thing in the hedge. Now, in spite of that laugh, he was almost sure that off the distance a wee cry answered him. So to make sure, he called again, but this time, though he strained his ears till the drums ached, he caught no reply. And now, out of the murkiness in the road ahead of him, something began to grow slowly into a tall, slender white figure. Motionless it stood, tightly wrapped in a winding sheet. In his presence, a new and awful fear pressed down the heart of Darby. He felt, too, that another shade had taken its place behind him and didn't want to look, and he strove against looking, but something forced the lad to turn his head, and there, sure enough, not five feet away, stood as still as and silent the tall, dark figure of a man in a topcoat. Then came from every direction low, hissing whispers that the lad couldn't understand.
and something terrible would happen in a minute. Oh, Darby knew that well. Something terrible was about to happen. Now, there's just so much fear in every man, just exactly as there is a certain amount of courage, and when this fear is all spilled, a man either fights or dies. At least, so Darby had always said. And he remembered there was a gap in the hedge nearly opposite the clump of willows, so he made up his mind that come what might, he'd make a grand charge for it, and so into the upland meadow beyond. Darby waited for an instant to get some strength back into his knees, and then he gave a spring. But that one spring was all he made. Well, in that direction, at least. For as he neared the ditch, a dozen white, ghostly hands reached out eager for him. With a gasp, he whirled in the thrucks and rushed and mad to the willows opposite, and there a hundred ghastly fingers were stretched out to meet the poor lad. And as he staggered back into the middle of the road again, the hero couldn't say to save his soul, keep back a long cry of terror and distress. Immediate, from under the willows and from the niche near the hedge and in the air above his head from the countless dead lips echoed the triumphant, unearthly laugh. It was then Darby just nearly gave up for Frost. He felt his eyes growing dim and his limbs going numb, and there was no air coming into his lungs, and he wished for an RT, for when he tried to breathe, he only gaped, and so that he knew the black spell was upon him, and that all that was left for him to do was to sink down into the road and then to die. Aye. But at that minute, there floated from a great way off the faint cry of a voice. The despairing man knew well.
"Oh, you keep up your heart, Darby O'Gill," cried Brian Connors. "We're coming to rescue ye."
And from over the fields, a wild cheer followed in words.
"Oh, fa-ba-la-la-la-la-la, clear the way, clear the way,"
sprang the shrill cry of a thousand of the good people. At the first sound of the king's words, there arose about Darby the mighty flurrying and rushing of wings in the darkness, as if tremendous birds were rising up sudden and flying away, and the air emptied itself of a smothering heaviness. And so fast came the king's fairy army that the great cheer was still echoing among the trees when the gold crown of Brian Connors sparkled up from beside the knowledgeable man's knees, and at that the persecuted man, sobbing with joy, knelt down the muddy road to shake hands with his friend, the master of the good people. Now Brian Connors was not alone, no, for there crowded about Darby, sympathizing with him, little Phelan Begg, and Neil the fiddler, and Sean Rue the smith, and Frederick Og. Also every instant, flittering out of the sky into the road, came by the score green-cloaked and red-hooded men following the king and ready for trouble.
"Oh, if ever a man needed a drop of good whiskey, you're the hero, ho-hoo!
And this is the time and place for it," says the king, handing up a silver-topped noggin.
"You drink it all, my good man," he says, "and then we'll escort you home, Darby. Come on, Darby," says he.
And the master of the night's time turned and shouted to his subjects,
"Boys, we'll go visible now for the better of the company's sake, eh? And do you make the illumination so Darby can see yous with him?"
At that, the lovely rosy light, which, as you may remember, our hero first saw in the fairy's home at Slieve Manon back in the day, lighted up the roadway. And under the leafy arches, bobbing along like a regiment of soldiers, all in their green cloaks and red caps, marched at least a thousand of the little people, with Phaedrus Og at their head, acting as a general. And as they passed the mill, five defiant pipers made the battered old windies rattle with Gary Owen. What was the rescue? But it takes us to Chapter 4, The Coast of Bower. Aye. And so the green-dressed little army, all in the sweet rosy light they made, went marching to the merry music of the pipes over the tree-bowered roadway, past the haunted breaks, up the shivering hills, and down into the waiting dales, making the grim night melodious. And for a long space, not a word, good or bad, or indifferent, said Darby. But a sparrow woke her drowsy children to take a look at the beautiful procession, and a robin called excited to her sleeping neighbors, and the linnets and the hares and the rabbits and the hundreds of the like all crowded about in the daylighted through the bushes and stood peering through the glistening leaves as their well-known companions went by. A dozen venturesome young owls flew from bough to bough, following along, cracking good-natured friendly jokes at their friends and fairies. Then other birds came flying from miles around, twittering jubilation. But the stern-jawed, frowny-eyed little people,
for once answered back never a word, but marched as stiff and silent as soldier should. You'd swear 'twas the Enniskillens or the 18 Hussars that was in it.
Aye. Ooh, isn't that General Julius Caesar at the head? Ooh, says one brown owl, flapping out an audacious wing at Frederick Oak. Who? Who? Julius Caesar, who? No, no, cries his brother, another young villain. 'Tis only the Duke of Wellington. But look at the bothered face and Darby O'Gill. Ooh, whoosh, are the good people going to hang Darby? Ooh.
In faith, then, sure enough, there was a mighty little elevation on the features of our hero. For as he came marching along, silent and moody, beside the king, what to do with the banshee's comb was bothering the heart right out of Darby. And if he'd only thrown it to the ghosts when he was there at the mill, that terrible laugh had crunched all sense and reason out of the boy, and so that he forgot to do that very wise thing. Oh, Cone, and now the ghost knew that Darby had it, and so to throw it away would do no good unless they'd find it after. One thing was certain. He must some way get it back to the banshee or else be haunted all the rest of his days, himself and the parish around. He was sore hearted, too, at the king, and a bit crass-tempered because the little man had stayed away so long from visiting him. But at last the knowledgeable man found his tongue.
Be my faith, king,
he complained.
'Tis a cure for sore eyes to see ye, it is, and I might have been dead and barely than you none the wiser, says he all sulky-like.
Oh, sure, I've been out to the country a fortnight, says the king, and I've only returned within the hour. I went on a sudden call to prevent a terrible war betwixt the French fairies and the German fairies, and I've been 2 weeks on an island in the River Ryan, betwixt France and Germany, don't you know? The river is called after an Irishman by the name of Ryan.
Aye, well, at least you might have sent me word, says Darby.
Oh, I didn't think I'd be gone so long, good man, says the fairy. But the disputation was tremendous, he says.
And the little man drew himself up all dignified and scowled solemn at Darby.
They left it for me to decide, and this was the contention. 50 years ago, a swan belonging to the French fairies laid a set of eggs on that same island, and then comes along a German swan, and what does the impotent creature do but set herself down on the eggs laid by the French swan and hatched them? After that, the hatching, the German men claimed the young ones, but the Frenchmen peremptorily demanded them back, do you mind? And the German men defied them, do you see? So, of course, the trouble started, for 50 years has been growing, and before fighting as a last resort, they sent for me.
Well, I saw at once what at the bottom of the oar was the old question which has been disturbing the world and driving people crazy for 3,000 years, eh?
Ah, yes, I know, says Darby scornful. 'Twas whether the hen that laid the egg or the hen that hatched the egg, the mother of the chicken.
Oh, hey, yeah, you are a knowledgeable man. Yes, nothing else but that. Now, what do you think I decided? He says.
Well, now, Your Honour, I'll always blame Darby for not listening to the king's decision, because 'tis a matter I've studied myself considerable and never could rightly conclude. But Darby, at the time, was so bothered, he only said in reply to the king,
Well, sure, it's little I know, or sorrow little I care, Darby says sulky. I've got something more important than hen's eggs troubling me mind, and maybe you can help me, king, dear, he says, anxious. Hurrah, out with it then, man, says the king. And we'll find a way, Avernine, he says, cheerful.
With that, Darby up and told everything that had happened Halloween night since, and indeed, be saying,
here's this broken piece of comb in my pocket, and what to do with it, I don't know. Will you take it to the banshee, king?
The king turned grave as a goat.
I wouldn't touch that thing in your pocket, good friends, we are, to save your life, Darby. Not for 100 pounds, neither. It might give them power over me, you see. Yours is the only mortal hand that ever touched the banshee's comb, and yours is the hand that should restore it. Oh, my, look at that now, says Darby in despair, nodding his head very solemn. Besides, says the king, without noticing, there's only one ghost in Crogmaw I associate with, and that's Sean. They're mostly uncultivated down there, and almost redundant. Although I'd hate to call anyone redundant unless I had to, says a just-minded old man. Well, then I'll just throw it here in the road and let some of them find it, says Darby, desperate. I'll take the chance.
The king was shocked, and throwing up a warning hand, he said,
Be no manner of means, Darby O'Gill. You forget that them ghosts are once men and women like yourselves, so in gold concern are about, they're not to be trusted.
If one should find the comb, he mightn't give it to the banshee at all. He mightn't turn Bezler and buzzle it. No, no, no. You must give it to herself personal, or else you and Bridget and the children will be haunted all your days, and there's no time to lose either, says he. But Bridget and the children are waiting for me this minute, wailed Darby. And the pony, what's become of her and me supper?
A little lad who was marching just ahead turned round and spoke.
Aye, the pony's tied up in the stable, and Bothered Bill has gone sneaking off to the McCaskies, the little man says. I saw them as I flew past.
Phaedric, shouted the king.
Donald, Con, Neil, Phelim, he called.
With that, the little men name rose up the ranks, their cloaks spread, and they come flying back like big green butterflies, and they stopped hovering in the air above Darby and the king.
What's wanted?
Asked Phelim.
Does any of you know what the banshees do at this hour?
The king replied.
Yeah. She's due in County Roscommon at Castle O'Flynn, if I don't misremember,
spoke the little fiddler.
But I think since Halloween she ain't working much, and perhaps she won't leave Croagmore.
Oh, well, has any one of you seen Sean the knight in the know? Asked the master.
Sorrow one of me knows,
said Phaedric.
Nor I,
cried one after the other. Well, ah.
Yous go and find the banshees where the banshees stay, and you all. All y'all go, and some of yous, excepting Phaedra, go look for Sean, and tell him that I want to see him particular, says the king.
The five hovering little lads vanished like a candle that's been blown out.
As for you, Phaedric, went on the master fairly, you tell the regiment there to guard this town in this night, and keep the ghost out of it. Begin at once.
Now the words weren't well said till the whole regiment had blown itself out, and again the night closed in as black as a hat. But as it did, Darby caught a glimpse from afar of the golden light of his own open door, and he thought he could see on the threshold the shadow of Bridget, with one of the children clinging to her skirt, and herself watching with a hand shading her eyes.
"Oh, do you go home to your supper now, me poor man," says the king. "And meantime, I'll engage Sean to guide us to the banshee. He's a great comrade of hers, don't you? And he'll pacificate her if anyone can."
Now, the idea of becoming acquainted personal with the ghosts and in a friendly, pleasant way of having dealings with them was a new sensation at Darby.
Oh, well, what'll I do now? Oh, you go home to your supper, says the king, and you meet me by the withered tree at Conroy's crossroads at the stroke of 12. There'll be little danger tonight, I'm thinking, but if you should run up against one of them spalpeens, throw the bit of comb at him, maybe he'll take it to the banshee, maybe he won't. At any rate, it's the best she can do. Well, don't you keep me waiting at the crossroads now, whatever else happens.
Warned Darby.
I'll do me best endeavour, says the king. But be sure to recognise me when I come. Make no mistake, for you'll have to speak first, he says.
They were walking along all this time, and now the lad had come to Darby's own style. The lad could see the heads of the children bunched up against the window pane. The king stopped, and laying a hand on Darby's arm, spoke up impressive.
If I come to the crossroads as a cow with the rope about me horns, you'll lead me. If I come as a horse with a saddle on me back, you'll ride me, all right? But if I come as a pig with a rope tied to me left hind leg, you drive me, says the king.
Oh, my
tail and ages,
says Darby.
But,
says the king, waving his hand against interruptions,
so that we'll know each other, we'll have a byword betwixt us, and it'll be poetry,
he says,
so that I'll know 'tis you that's in it, and you'll say, cabbage and bacon, and so that you'll know that it's me that's in it, I'll answer, will stop the heart aching.
Cabbage and bacon will stop the heart aching, says the king, growing invisible.
That's good, satisfying poetry, he says.
But the last words were sounded out of the empty air and a little way above, for the master of the night time had vanished. At that, Darby went into his supper. Now, I won't expatiate to your honour on how our hero spent the evening at home, or how after Bridget and the children were in bed, that a growing desire to meet and talk sociable with a ghost brought with 20 black fears and almost beat them. But whenever his mind hesitated, as it always did at the thought of the coast of Bower, a finger poked into his waistcoat pocket where the broken bit of comb lay hid and turned the scale. However, at length and at last, just before midnight, our hero dressed once more for the road, went splashing and plodding up the lane toward Conroy's crossroads. Now, a man is never so brave as when sitting for an instant his own comfortable fire. A hot supper asleep in his chest, a steaming noggin, a flagrant punch in his fist, and a well-tried pipe betwixt his teeth. At such times he ruminates on the old ancient heroes, and he decides there were no great shakes after all.
they have the chance to show themselves, and that's the only difference between betwixt himself and themselves.
When he's flung sudden out of unpleasant circumstances, as Darby was, to go charging around in the darkness, hunting unknown and invisible dangers, much of that courage oozes out of him, doesn't it? And so the strangest of all things was that this night, when 'twas his fortune to be taken up to the coast of Bower, that the dread of the death coach was present in his mind for the minute he shut the door on himself. It outweighed all the other fears. Now, in spite of the insurance that King Brian had given, in spite of the knowledge that his friends, the good people, were flying hither and thither over that town, and there crept into his soul and fastened itself there the chance that the headless driver might slip past them all and gobble him up. In vain, Darby told himself, there are a million spots in Ireland where the death carriage was more likely to be in his than his own path. But in spite of all reasons, a dread and shivering feeling was in his bones. And so as Darby splashed along, he was flinging anxious looks behind or trembling at the black wavering shadows in front. Howsoever, there was some comfort in knowing that the weather was changing for the better. Strong winds had swept the worst of the storm out over the ocean. There it lingered slow, growling and sputtering a wee bit of lightning. A few scattered frowning clouds, throwing ugly looks at the moon, sulked behind.
"Oh, Lord love your shining face,"
said Darby, looking up to where the full moon, as big as the bottom of a tub, shone bright and clear over his head.
"And his eye... It's I that hopes that the blackguard of a cloud I see creeping over at you from Sleeve the Mon won't reach you and squinch your light up before I meet up with Brian Connors."
Now the moon in answer brushed a cloud from her face and shed a clearer, fuller light that made the flooded fields and dropped trees quiver and glisten. On top of the little mound known as Conroy's Hill, and which is just this side of where the Croads cross, the friends of the fairies looked about over the lonesome countryside. Here and there gleamed a distant farmhouse, a still white speck in the moonlight. Only at Con Kelly's, which was a good mile down the road, was a friendly spark of light to be seen, and that spark was so dim, was so far, that it only pressed down the loneliness heavier on Darby's heart.
"Oh, wisha," says Darby. "How much I'd rather be there, Mary, making with the boys and the girls, than standing here lonesome and cold, waiting for the devil knows what."
Darby strained his eyes to the sight of a horse, or a cow, or a pig, or anything that might turn out to be Brian Connors. The only thing that moved was a huge dark cloud that stretched up from Sleeve na Mon, and its heavy edge already touched the rim of the moon. So Darby started down the hill. The withered tree at the crossroads where he was to meet the king waved its blackened arms and lifted them up in warning as he came toward it, and it dripped cold tears upon his caubeen and down his neck when he stood quaking in its shadows.
"Oh, if the headless coach were to catch me here," he whimpered, "and fling me into his carriage, not a soul on earth would ever know what become of me." "Huh, I wish I wasn't so knowledgeable,"
Darby says, half crying.
"I wish I was as ignorant about ghosts and fairies as little Mrs. Bradigan, who laughs at them. The more you know, the more you need know. Oh, musha, musha, there goes the moon."
And at them words, the great blacker moon and cloud closed in on the moon and left the world as black as your hat. That wasn't the worst of by no manner of means. But at the same instant there came a crash, a wind, and with a low rumble froze the marrow in Darby's bones. He strained his eyes toward the sound. It was so dark he couldn't see his hand before his face. He tried to run, but his legs turned to blocks of wood and defied him. All the time the rumble of the terrible coach drew nearer and nearer, and he felt himself helpless as a babe. He closed his eyes to shut the horrors of the headless driver out and of the poor dead men laying him back against the seat. At that last minute, a swift hope that the king might be within hearing sent him a flash of strength, and he called out the byword.
"Cabbage and bacon!"
he cried out despair.
"Cabbage and bacon will stop the heart aching!"
he roared dismally, and then he gave a great gasp. It was a splash of the road for an instant. The three and a tremendous black coach and four giant horses and the coachman up in the box stood still as death before him. The driver wore a brown greatcoat, the lines hung limp in his fingers, and Darby's great stopped palpitating at the sight of the two broad headless shoulders. The knowledgeable man strove out to cry out again, and he only croaked like a crack of raven.
"Cabbage and bacon will stop the heartache, and scrabbage and bacon will stop the heartache,"
Darby says. Something moved inside the coach.
"Oh, you foolish man! You've not only given the byword, but at the same time you've shouted out its answer."
At the voice of the King, for 'twas King Brian Connors it was, a great weakness came over Darby and he leaned limp against the tree.
Suppose,
the king went on,
that it was an enemy who'd met up instead of a friend here announced he'd have your secret and maybe just put the come hither on ye. Sean,
he says up to the driver,
this is the human being we're to take with us down to Crogmore to meet the Banshee.
Now, from a place down on the seat on the far side of the driver, a deep, slow voice. A deep, slow voice that sounded as though it had fur on it spoke up.
I'm glad to substantiate any service that will in any way conduce to the amelioration of any friend of the renowned King Brian Connors, even though that friend be only a human being. I was a humble human being myself 300 or 400 years ago.
At that statement, Darby, out of politeness, tried to look surprised.
You must be a duke or an earl or some other rich philosopher to have the most renowned fairy in the world to take such a shine to you, went on the head that was sitting on the seat, do you mind? As Rick guessed it.
Well, haven't you seen enough to make yourself like him?
Said the king, raising half his body through the open window.
Didn't you mark how calm and bold he stood waiting for you, when any other man in Ireland would be this time and have wore his legs and knees for running from you? Where's the philosopher except Darby O'Gill, who would have guessed that 'twas myself that was in the coach and would have flung me the byword so careless and handy?
Cried the king, with his face blazing with admiration. The words put the pride into the heart of our hero, and pride the world over is the twin sister of courage. And then, too, whilst the king was talking, deep and obstreperous cloud which had covered the sky slipped off the edge of the moon, hard to join its fellows who were waiting for it out over the ocean. And the moon, to make amends for its late obscuration, showered down a sudden flood of cheerful silver light, the drooping separate leaves and glistening blades of grass leapt up clean and laughing to the eye. Some of that cheer went into Darby's breast, and with that crept back fresh his old confidence in his champion, the king. But the headless driver was talking.
O'Gill, says the voice, slow again. Did I hear you say O'Gill, Brian Connors? Surely not one of the O'Gills from Ballintubber.
Now Darby answered reluctant and haughty, for he had a feeling that the monster was going to claim relationship, and the idea put a bad taste in his mouth.
Or my father's people came from Ballintubber, he says.
Well, come this or come that,
says the deep voice, coming again from the head on the seat beside the headless driver, and trembling with excitement.
I'll have one look at ye.
No sooner said than done, for that saying the coachman twisted, and picking up an extraordinarily big head from the seat beside him, he held it up in his two hands and faced it to the road. 'Twas the face of a giant, it was. The lad marked that its wiry red whiskers grew close under its eyes, and the flaming hair of the head curled and rolled down to where the shoulders should have been, and he saw, too, that the nose was wide and the eyes were little, an uglier face you couldn't have wished to observe. But as he looked, the boy saw the great lips tighten and grow wide, and the eyelids half closed, and the head gave a hoarse sob, and the tears trickled down its nose. The head was crying. First, Darby grew uncomfortable-like. And when he felt himself insulted to be cried at that way by a total stranger, and as the tears rolled faster and faster, and the sobs came louder and louder, and the ugly eyes kept leering at him affectionate, he grew hot with indignation. Seeing which, the head spoke up, snivelling.
No, please, please, don't get pugnacious. Oh, no, yet, this potatoes, it begged between sobs. 'Tisn't your face that hurts me and makes me cry. Oh, no, no, I've seen worse, a great deal worse, many's the time. But what is the amazing family resemblance that paint the lie in my heart, Mr. O'Gill?
The driver lifted the tail of his coat and wiped the head's two weeping eyes.
'Twas in Ballintubber I was born, in Ballintubber I was reared, and it's there I came to the misfortune through love of a pretty fair maid named Margaret Ellen O'Gill. Oh, there was a song about it, he says.
Oh, I've heard it many, many a time, says the king, nodding, sympathizing, though not for the last 100 years or so.
Darby glared scornful at the king.
Vo, 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 wailed the head. But if you like her, it wasn't for her bunchy red hair, and for the big brown wind that was on her forehead. You'd be as like as two peas in a pod.
Hurrah, says Darby Brustin. I'm ashamed to see a man of your sense on the station, he says, and high dictation. You leave off,
broke in the king, pulling Darby by the sleeve.
You come inside. Whatever else you do, respect the sentimentalities. They're all we have to live for, ghost or mortal, says he.
And so, grumbling, Darby took a place within the coach beside his friend. He filled his pipe, and he
was borrowing a bit of fire from that of the king, when, looking up, he saw just back of the driver's seat and opening into the carriage a square hole of about the height and width of two of your hands, aye. And said again the hole, staring affectionate down at him, was the head, and it smiling, languaging-like.
"Oi, well, be this and be that,"
Darby growled back to low to the king.
"If he don't take his face out of that window, ghost or no ghost, I'll take a poke at him." "By no manner of means, will you?"
says the king, anxious.
What do we do without him? We'll be at Krogmaw in a few minutes, and then we needn't bother you." "Oh, well, why don't we drive on then?"
says Darby, looking up at the surly head.
"Why don't you start?"
"We've been going for these last 3 minutes," smiled Sean. "We're coming up to Kilmartin Churchyard now."
"Oh, see, Sean, lad, have you passed Tom Grogan's public house yet?"
asked the king, starting up anxious. "I have, but I can turn back again," says the face, lighting up interested-like.
"Oh, well, I think keep the best whiskey there in this part of Ireland,"
says the king.
"Would you mind stepping in and bringing us out a sup, Darby Agraw?"
Do I get the feeling that King Brian O'Connor's is related to someone else that remain unnamed in our audience tonight? Mistress Tom Grogan was a tall, irritated woman with sharp corners all over her and a temper that was like an east wind. She was standing at her own door arguing with Garge McKibney and Willem Broderick and dealing them out horrid names, whilst her husband, Tom, a mild little man, stood within leaning on the bar, smoking sedately. Now Garge and Willem were arguing back at Mistress Grogan, telling her what a fine-looking and respectable woman she was, and they couldn't have dropped one more. Wouldn't they have just one more drop before going home, when they saw coming sliding along through the air toward them? Aye, they saw coming sliding through the air, about 4 feet above the ground, mind you. A decent-dressed man, sitting comfortable, his pipe in his mouth, one leg crossed over the other. The stranger stopped in the air not 5 feet away, and in the moonlight they saw him plain knock the ashes from his pipe and stick it in the rim of his caubeen. Now, being getting on 8 p.m. and closing time, they thought maybe they would just head off. But they said, "You know, we've got a few more minutes left. We can tell you the rest of the story, so why don't you stick around for it then? You don't need to leave just yet." And so they catched hold of each other, and gasping as he stepped down out of the air to the ground and wishing them the top of the evening, he brushed past, and he walked bold to the bar and briskly called for 3 jorums of whiskey. Now Tom, oblivious, for he hadn't seen, handed out the drinks, and the stranger, natural as you please, emptied one, wiped his mouth with the back of his hand, and started for the door carrying the 2 other jorums. Now Tom, of course, followed out to see who was in the road, and then he clutched hold of the 3 others, and the 4, gripping each other like lobsters biling in the pot, clung speechless, swagging back and forth. Sure, 'twas no wonder, mind you, for what they saw the strange man lift the 2 cups into the naked air, and then they saw plain the 2 jorums leave the man's hands, Darby O'Gill's hands, mind you, and they saw those 2 jorums tip themselves slowly over until the bottoms were uppermost, not one drop of the liquor spilling to the ground, and they saw no more. For they each gave a different kind of roar when Darby turned to bring back the empty vessels. The next second Tom Grogan was flying like a hunted rabbit over the muddy potato field behind his own stable, was Willem Broderick and Garge McGibney were dashing furious after him like the skipperbeg hounds. But Mrs. Grogan didn't run away, because she was on her own threshold, lying flat on her back, and for the first time in her life, speechless. However, with a rumble and a roar, the coach with the travellers went away. The good liquor supplied all that last sight lacked that was needful to put our 3 heroes in good humour, and themselves, and with each other, so that it wasn't long before, their troubles being forgot, they were conversing sociable and unfamiliar one with the other. Darby, to improve his information, was striving to make the best of the situation by asking knowledgeable questions.
"So what kind of disposition has a man she had to know?" he asked after a time.
"Oh, well, she's a fine creature. And very refined, and only a bit too fond of crying and wailing for me," says Sean.
"Oh, sure," says the knowledgeable man. "I know several living women that kept fits. Sure does she do nothing but wail death keens. Has she had no good love ballads or songs like that? I think she'd grow tired."
"Oh, don't you be talking," says Sean. "'Tis she who can sing them. She has one in particular, the ballad of Mary McGinnis. Oh, that I wish you could hear her at that," he says. "The song has a splendid 3 tunes to it, and the tune changes at every verse.
I wished I had it done all, but I'll sing you what I have, he says. With that, the head began to sing, in a fine, deep singing voice it had, too, only maybe a little too roaring for love ballads.
Come, O ye true lovers, wherever ye may be, likewise ye deceivers by land or by sea, I hope that ye listen with pity to me, says the jeweler, me life is a traitor.
Yet here's where the tone changes, says the head, licking his lips.
I'm going to church last Sunday, my true love passed me by. I knew her mind was changed by the twinkling of her eye. I knew her mind was changed, for she calls for me to moan. It is a terrible black misfortune to think she called her grown.
That's what I call real poetry, says Darby. Why, there's no finer, says the king, standing up on the seat, his face a-beaming.
Oh, you wait for the next verse, then you cry the salty tears, says Sean.
And he sang very affecting.
Oh, dig me a grave, both large, wide and deep. I'd lay me down gently to take me long sleep. Put a stone at me head and a stone at me feet, since I cannot get Mary McGinnis.
Oh, faith, 'tis a poignant and pitiful song, says Darby. I'd give a great deal if only I had it, he says he. Oh, Bouchard, who knows, maybe you can get it, says the old king with a wink. You may demand the favours of three wishes for bringing her what you're bringing her, he whispered. Sean, Sean, he says out loud, do you think the banshee'll give that song for bringing back the lost comb, I dunno?
Well, I don't know myself, says the head dubious.
Because if she would, here's the man whose comb has the comb, and he's bringing it back to her.
At this the head gave a start, and its eyes bulged with gladness. Well, it's a lucky man I am entirely then, says the head. For she promised to stick me head on and let me wear it permanent like if only I'd bring tidings of the comb, says Sean. She's been in a bad way since she lost it. You know that creature can sing only when she's combing her hair. Since the comb's broke, her voice has cracked scandalous and she's bitter ashamed. So she is. But here's Crogmaw right before us. Will you just go in and take a drop of something, says he.
Sticking out his head, Darby saw towering up in the night gloom bleak Crogmaw, the mountain of ghosts. And as he thought of the thousands of shivering things inside and of the unpleasant feelings he'd given him at Charter's Mill a few hours before, a doubt came into Darby's mind as to whether it were best to trust himself inside. He might never come out. However, the king spoke up, saying, "Thank you kindly, Sean, but you know well that yourself and one or two others are the only ghosts I associate with. And so we'll just step out and do you go yourself and tell all the banshees, tell the banshee that we're awaiting out here, all right? You return with your Sean, for you must take Darby back."
With that, the two heroes descended from the coach, and glad enough was Darby to put his brogue safe and sound on the road again. Now all at once, the side of the mountain ran into them open with a great crash, and Sean with the coach and horses disappeared in a rush and were swallowed up by that mountain, which closed after him.
Darby was blinking and shivering beside the king, when sudden, and without a sound, the banshee stood before them.
Aye, she was all in white, and her yellow hair streeled to the ground, and the weight of sorrow and ages were on her pale face.
"Is that you, Brian Connors?" she says. "And is that the one with you, the man who grabbed me?"
"You're most obedient," says the king, bowing low. "And it was an accident," says he.
"Oh, accident or no accident," the banshee says, severe-like. "'Tis the fine lot of trouble he's caused me. "'Tis the elegant lot of trouble we'd had this night if you hadn't saved him,' she says."
The banshee spoke in a hollow voice, which once in a while did break into a squeak.
"'Will you let bygones be bygones, ma'am, if you please,' says Darby. "'And I brought you back your comb, and by your leave I ask the favour of three wishes.'
Now, some way or other, he wasn't so afeard now that the king was near, and besides one square, cool look at any kind of trouble, even 'tis a ghost, takes half the dread from it, don't it?
I have only two favours to grant any mortal man, says she, and here they are.
With that, she handed Darby two small black stones with things carved on them.
The first stone will make you invisible if you rub the front of it. It will make you visible again if you rub the back of it. They put the other stone in your mouth, and you can mount and ride the wind, so Sean needn't drive yous back, she says.
The king's face beamed with joy.
Oh, by the hokey, Darby, me lad, think of the larks we'll have travelling nights together over Ireland ground, and maybe we'll go across the sea.
But fairies can't cross running water, says Darby, wondering.
Oh, that's all superstition,
says the king.
Didn't I cross the River Rhine? But, ma'am, says he, you have a third favour and one I'm wishing for mightily myself, and that is that you'll teach us the ballad of Mary McGuinness.
The banshee blushed.
Oh, I have a cold, she says.
'Tis the way with singers, says the king, winking at Darby.
But we'll thank you to do your best, ma'am.
Well, the banshee took out her comb and fastened it to the broken end. She passed it through her hair a few times and began the song. At first, her voice was pretty weak and trembling-like. But the more she combed, the stronger it grew, till at last it rose high and clear and sweet and wild as Darby'd heard it that Halloween night up at the McCarthy's. Now the two heroes stood in the shadow of a tree, Darby listening and the king busy writing down the song. At the last word, the place where she had been standing flashed empty, and Darby never saw the banshee again. No, I wish I had all the song to let you hear it, and maybe one day I'll be learning it from Darby myself, and by the next time perhaps we meet. And I wish I had time to tell you now how Darby one day had made himself invisible and lost the stone, and how bothered Bill Donahue had found it, and how Bill, rubbing it by accident, made himself invisible at the terrible time that Darby had finding him. But I think we've gone too long tonight already anyway. So that's the conclusion of our story of the Banshee's Comb, aye, the Banshee's Halloween, as it were. And I do hope you've enjoyed our tale tonight.
You've just heard tonight's story from Storylink Radio's Countdown to Halloween 2022. Remember to come back for our next tale. Many more stories of all genres available to listen to and read along with now on our website at www.storylinkradio.com. Visit our YouTube channel at youtube.com/storylinkradio. And visit our podcast for easy mobile listening anywhere, anytime. Just search for Storylink Radio on your favorite podcast provider. Oh, and don't forget to hit the subscribe button and click that alert bell for Storylink Radio.